Judaism, the Jewish faith, and Christianity. What we're going to do today is not explore the Christian religion, nor even discuss the history of Christianity. We're going to focus on one angle, and that is the way the founder of Christianity and some of its elements are treated in the Talmud, in the literature of Gemara. And this is a quite unknown topic to many, including many Jews, and there's a good reason for it. Because for hundreds of years, even when Jews studied Gemara, most of these pieces of Gemara they could not study because they were censored. Most of the Talmudic volumes that were printed in Christian countries had to undergo a censor, and therefore either the Jews themselves or the censor who was a Jew or not Jew deleted these pieces of Gemara. They were compiled in relatively recent times in a little tiny volume called Chesroinus HaShas, meaning all the pieces that were deleted that are missing from the original Shas. They did exist in those few editions of Talmud that were not scrutinized by the Christian censorship. And today, obviously, living in a very different climate and time, these are readily available. We're going to explore those pieces of the Talmud. We're going to explore how the rabbis and the sages dealt with them. We're going to see the views of some of the Rishonim. And finally, we're going to address the topic based on discussions in the Kabbalistic and Chassidic sources. Now, obviously, this is quite a large topic, one of the most painful, tragic, and bloody themes of Jewish history, because hundreds of thousands, essentially millions of Jews, have been hunted down, persecuted, suffered, tortured, murdered over the last two millennia as a result of this. And needless to say and to describe how much misery and agony this caused our people, today, however, we can look at things in retrospect and gain some perspective and gain some hashkafa, which we want to do today, Be'ezer Hashem Yisbarach. You have source sheets, which we printed out. You should have two pages. One of them is double-sided. Are there more? That's a good question. I don't know if there are more. Does anybody see any more source sheets? If not, maybe you could look with somebody. Okay. If you don't have... Yes, it's even being seen live. It's even live. If you get bored, you can go home and you can watch it live. Okay, no problem, yeah. You can go on the yeshiva.net, it's live, and will be replayed later. And you have there the sources too, the source sheets. Take a look at your first source. So Gemara in Soita, Daf Mem Zayin Amid Aleph. See Soita Mem Zayin Aleph, Soita 47a. You have the same Gemara also in Sanhedrin, Daf Kuv Zayin Amid Beis, 107b. As I mentioned, these Gemaras are not available in most prints of the Vilna Shas. You will not find this. They were deleted. Or even if they weren't deleted, the name was deleted. The story may be there, but the names are often not there, the name of the person involved. But it's clear, as we know from Chesroinus HaShas and other editions, who the Gemara is referring to. And here I put it in with the complete and accurate text. Zog the Gemara, Tana Rabbanon, the rabbis taught, La'olam te'ismol doichi v'yamin mekareves. In life, you always have to develop the ideal where your left arm rejects and your right arm embraces and brings close. Meaning you have to have the proper balance, equilibrium between love and discipline, between closeness and distance. Your left arm, which is the weaker arm, is the one that rejects. Your right arm, which is the stronger arm, is the one that embraces, that demonstrates affection and love. Loike Elisha shedachvay legechazi b'shtey yadav, v'loike Yeshua ben Prachya shedachafay. Not like Elisha, who rejected his student Gehazi with both of his hands. The Gemara tells that story and then adds, and not like Yehoshua ben Prachi, who rejected Shadacha Foyla HaNoitzri, who rejected the Noitzri, the one from Nazareth, from Nazareth, or in some of the texts, Echad Mitalmid of one of his students, Bishtei Yadav, with both of his hands, he completely rejected him. What's the story of Yeshua ben Prachya, who was one of the earliest Tanoim? Do you have a siddur there? Oh, here, okay. Yeshua ben Prachya is one of the earliest Tanoim who's mentioned where? Who's mentioned in Pirkei Avos in the first chapter. And the Pirkei Avos discusses over there the history of the tradition of the sages during the Second Temple, right? So you have the Anshei Knesset HaGdoila, the men of the Great Assembly, who were the members of the 120 members of the Great Assembly, with the last one, Shimon HaTzadik, who really resurrected and created a renaissance of Torah and Yiddishkeit after the terrible destruction of the first Beis HaMikdash during the Second Aliyah, after they built the second Beis HaMikdash. And then there was a period of Zugos, of the great sages, the peers, Zugos, peers, so to speak, couples of scholars, who taught, which morphed into the era that we know as the Tanoim. And Yeshua ben Prachi is mentioned in Pirkei Avos as one of the Zugos, Yeshua ben Prachi together with Nitai Har Bailey, who then had this famous students of Yehuda ben Tabai and Shimon ben Shattach, whose students were Shmaya and Aftalion, who were actually converts, whose students were Hillel and Shammah. So just to put it in perspective, so Yeshua ben Prachya lives in the middle of the era of the second Beis HaMikdash, and the Gemara now tells a story about him. He escaped the land of Israel as a result of the terrible persecutions of a king named Alexander Yanai, or the Greek name is known as Alexander Janius, who was a grandson of the Chashmonaim, the original Chashmonaim who gave us the holiday of Hanukkah that we just finished celebrating yesterday, Zeis Hanukkah. So Alexander Yanai was a grandson of the original Chashmonaim, but he himself became a tzeduki, a seducee, and dedicated much of his life to hunt down each one of the Prushim, the Pharisees, the Chachmi Yisrael, the sages who held on to the authentic tradition of Halacha of Torah Shebaal Peh. His wife, however, was a tzadekis, as is often the case till today. Her name was Shlom Tzion Hamalka, Shlom Tzion the queen, and when he died, she reigned for a decade, which was one of the most holistic, wholesome, prosperous, and blessed decades in the era of Bayis Sheni, which was characterized by civil war, by contention. As somebody once said, if we survived Bayis Sheni, we could survive anything. Between the Chashmonai families themselves, there was terrible civil war. The Ramban in Parshas Vayechi wonders, how is it that such a dynasty of a family that literally sacrificed its life to save the Jewish people during the times of the Greek-Syrian occupation, which gave us Hanukkah, and just in a few generations descended into so much corruption and civil war, bloody war. The Gemara says in a Mishnah in Sukkah, Daf Memches, that there was on Sukkahs, you remember the story, on Sukkahs, one of the traditions is Nisuch HaMaim, you pour water on the Mizbeach. And one of the Kohenim Gdolim was a tzeduki who didn't believe in the tradition of Torah Shebaal Peh. It doesn't say anywhere in Chumash that you pour water on the altar on Sukkahs. This is Halacha L'Moshe Mitzini, although the Gemara in Tainus deduces it from various verses, but it's a Halacha L'Moshe Mitzini, it's an oral tradition. Josephus identifies that Kohen Gadol in Mishnah Sukkah at Yosifun as Alexander Yanai. So when he lifted up the goblet of water that they used to draw from the Shiloyach River every morning of the days of Sukkot, and they danced all night Simchas Beis HaShayeva, he took the water, and instead of pouring it on the Mizbeach, the Mishnah says he poured it on his legs. And all the nation, the people that were there, pelted him with their esroigim, urigamu kala amba esroigayin, they pelted him with their esroigim. That's the story in the Gemara. The Gemara says late in the Mishnah, the Gemara says they damaged, the corner of the Mizbeach was damaged, they had to plug it with a bull shalmelach, with salt, so it should look good. Josephus adds that he murdered right there 6,000 Jews on Sukkot as a result of pelting him with a strigim. Explaining to you who Alexander Yanai was, and he killed most of Chachmi Yisrael, but he had a brother-in-law, Shimon ben Shatach, who was a student of Yeshua ben Prachya, whose sister, Shlomtzion, the queen, hid him from her husband's wrath, so he was saved. Shimon ben Shatach was saved. Yeshua ben Prachya fled to Egypt. When peace was restored somewhat and Alexander Yanai came back to his senses, Shimon ben Shatach, the brother-in-law of the king, tells Yeshua ben Prachya, come back home, you can come back to the land of Israel. Now Shimon ben Shatach was a student of Yeshua ben Prachya, so he calls him my Rebbe, my master. Yeshua ben Prachya was the president of the Sanhedrin, the Nasi of the Sanhedrin which was 71 members of the Supreme Jewish Court, which were all ordained from previous Sanhedrin all the way back to Moshe Rabbeinu. The president of the Sanhedrin essentially was the man who represented Moshe Rabbeinu in the generation, had the greatest authority of scholarship and legalities and Jewish law of the generation. This was Yeshua ben Prachya. So on the way back from Egypt to the land of Israel, so he could come back to his previous position, the Gemara now relates the following story of what happens. Quite a story. Kiyasa, on the way back, returning from Egypt, Ikla Lahu Shpiza. He stays at a certain hotel. I don't know if it was Motel 6, it was a Holiday Inn, or maybe it was even the Hilton. But some Ushpiza, some hotel or motel, or as they used to say, a kretschma. I don't know if that word is used much today. A kretschma, an inn, where half of the stories happened in the 18th and 19th century happened in kretschmas and inns. Rabbi Yeshua ben Prachya ended up staying in such an inn. Kam kamayu bi yakara shapir of the le yakara tuva. The hostess of the inn treated him and his entourage with tremendous glory, with tremendous honor. Yosef kamishtabach kamanach san yezu. So Yeshua ben Prachya was complimenting how pleasant, how beautiful is the behavior of this hostess, the way she's treating him and his entourage. Amaloi. So the Noitzri, his student, the Noitzri, says to him, Rebbe, you call this woman pleasant? Noah, Einah Trutos. Her eyes are round and ugly. How do you call this hostess pleasant? Amaloi, Yeshua ben Prachya says, Rasha. This is what you're thinking about. This is what you're involved in. This is what you're telling me. He's complimenting this woman on her behavior, and he's analyzing her looks, which he doesn't like. As Rashi says, she was a married woman. So he takes out 400 horns and he bans him. He excommunicates his student for this declaration, because as you can understand by the Tanoim, for his student to speak this way demonstrated that he cannot be his student. Each day, this student came back to Yeshua ben Prachya, but he rejected him. He didn't accept him. One day, Yeshua ben Prachya was saying Shema, and the student comes to him. That day, Yeshua ben Prachya decided enough is enough. It's time to accept him back to the yeshiva. It's time to re-embrace this student. But he was in the middle of Shema. In the middle of Shema, one can't communicate. So what did he do? So he made a signal with his hand, like you would say, something like this, right? Come back a little later. He doesn't say anything, but with his hand, he shows him, not now, maybe this, but he makes a signal demonstrating that he can't speak to him now. Savar, the student thought, Mat chedachile. He's rejecting him once again. Azal, he goes, Zakaf leveinasa. He erects a brick and polcha. He worships it. Meaning, he engages in pagan idolatry. Amalei. So now his Rebbe comes to him and says, Chazor boch, what are you doing? Come back. Come back. Amalei. So his student tells him, Kach mekublani mimcha. This is what I learned from you. Somebody who sins and causes everybody else to sin, such person is not given the opportunity to do tshuva, and therefore I can't return. And the Gemara says, why did he say about himself that he's a choyte or machte? The Amar Mar, and here you have the fateful word, which was deleted from so many editions. Yeshu, kishef, vehisis, vehidiach, vehechti es Yisra. That Yeshu engaged in kishef, in sorcery, in black magic. He instigated, and caused the Jewish people to sin and reject their God, their heritage, their faith. Says the Gemara, don't be like Yeshua ben Prachya. Yamin mekarev is a small doich, and not like Yeshua ben Prachya, who rejected his student with both of his arms. Who was a student? Yeshu, as the Gemara says here in Masechta Sota. Parenthetically, I once heard from the Lubavitcher Rebbe speaking on a Mishnah in Pirkei Avos, in the first Perek of Pirkei Avos, Yeshua ben Prachya Oimer, Aseh lecha chrav, uknei lecha chaver, veveidonas kol ha'adam lekaf zchus. Yeshua ben Prachya Oimer, this was something he would regularly say. You must have a mentor, you need a rav, you need a friend, get yourself a friend. And the third thing is, judge every person meritoriously. Give them the benefit of the doubt. If I could say this person is malicious, or this person means well, although they may be making a mistake, try to give people the benefit of a doubt, which, as you and I know, is quite a difficult thing, especially if it's somebody related to you. If it's not related to you, it's a Jew in China, it's not a problem. But if somebody related to you, it's a little hard, because of course, supposedly you know everything about them, you know them better than they know themselves. So he made a fascinating observation. Why was Yeshua ben Prachya the one who always said this? Because of this story. As a result of this story, he said in Yiddish, Flechte nachanan darumgein, he would go around and tell everybody, have a don es kola adam lekafschus, give people the benefit of the doubt. Because each day he came and asked to be accepted, he rejected him every day. And then the day when he finally wanted to accept him, this you have to call Morphy's law, we would call it divine providence, Hashgacha. That day he's in the middle of Kriya Shema. And look at the result of what happened. If we associate this Yeshu with the Yashke, with the Jesus that is known in the world, which we'll soon discuss, it's quite far from simple, as we will see. Look what happens. What's fascinating is, obviously Yeshu ben Prachya didn't know what's coming, right? He didn't know that 2,000 years later, nobody here is going to go to work on December 25th because he had a student who spoke about somebody's round eyes. Granted, we understand that and everything else. But the point is, and this is a general theme in Judaism, in Ashkaf, in Tanakh, and in Talmud, is that large historical events are traced back to one moment in time, one gesture, one moral word, thought, or action by a person at a particular moment, both positive or negative. Yosef HaTzadik saves the entire world from famine, including his whole family, the Jewish people, the Hebrew family. That's why we're here today. But how does it all happen? It happens, according to Parshas Vayeshev, at the end, because he's in prison. And he sees two people, not Jewish, who are in prison. One is a butler, one is a baker. Vihinam zoyafim. They look depressed, like most people early in the morning. They look depressed. And Yosef HaTzadik goes over to them. He puts his hand on their shoulders, perhaps. That's my addition. And he says four words to them. Madua pneichem royim hayoim. What's wrong? Why do you look sad today? Why are you dejected? What's going on? Talk to me. That's it, he does. He asks two people, why for us cooks to ice to chmurit to stachen to brachen to hakt? He doesn't do it in Yiddish. Whatever language he spoke to them in that exciting pit in Cairo. But that's his question. As a result of that question, they tell him their dream. He interprets their dream. 2 years later, Pare has a dream. The butler summons Yosef, and Pare appoints him as the prime minister of Egypt who saves the world. So what does it all begin with? A simple good morning, how are you, what's bothering you, to two non-Jews that you meet early in the morning and you want to know why they look depressed. Here, what the Gemara is saying is, he's in the middle of Kriyat Shema, and he goes like this, and from this comes a history of Yeshu HaNoitzri, which transformed literally the face of civilization in so many different ways, and transformed the fate and the destiny of the Jewish people in so many ways, in so many negative and painful ways, and we'll soon see from the Rambam in some positive ways as well. So this is the story in Gemara with Yeshua ben Prach. Shine. So Yeshua ben Prach used to go around and say, have a donus kala adam lekaf schus. Judge, give people the benefit of the doubt. Especially your students in yeshiva. Next piece of Gemara. Gittin dafnon zayin amid beis. Zok de heliki Gemara. Fascinating story. Here too, it was deleted from most editions of Gemara. Titus was Vespasian's son. Vespasian was the emperor of Rome who destroys the second Beis HaMikdash approximately in the year 68 of the Common Era. I say 68 because either it was 68, according to Rashi and Avodah Zarah Daf Tes, or it was 69, or it was 70. But it was one of those few years, that year when the Beis HaMikdash was destroyed, and when Vespasian dies, Titus, his son, becomes the new emperor of the great and powerful Roman Empire. And Titus has a nephew. His sister has a son who's very well known to us because we still read him and analyze him every week. And his name was Unculus. And Unculus, who was obviously growing up in royalty, and not just in royalty, he's a nephew of Titus, wants to know if it's really the right thing to join this people, the people of Israel. And through the famous, well-known, magical mechanism known in Chumash as Oiv, that's what Rashi says there in Gittin, Unculus interviews three people who have been around but are not here anymore. Three different people he interviews. And this is what the Gemara is saying. The first one he interviews is his uncle Titus. And he asks his uncle, in that world, which is the most prominent nation? And Titus says, Israel. So he says, should I join them? He says, you don't want to do that. It's too difficult, it's too exacting, it's too hard to be a Jew. So he tells Titus, so what should I do? Titus says, become an enemy of the Jew. Either you're a Jew or you become an enemy of the Jew, because if you become an enemy of the Jew, you'll also gain a lot of power in this world. That's his uncle's brilliant advice. The next piece of advice is Azal Askil Bilam, Binegida. Now he brings up Bilam through Negida. Negida is through sorcery, through magic. Amalei Manchashe Bahu Alma. Who's prominent in the next world? Amalo Yisrael. Bilam says the Jewish people. Maalid Bukibahu. Do you think I should cleave to them? I should become a Jew? Amalei, Bilam quotes him a pasuk. Bilam knew the Tanakh very, very well. He even wrote some of it. Amalei, I mean his prophecies in Parshas Balak. Amalei, loy sidra shleimam v'tevasam kalayam. Quoting a pasuk about something else. Right? You have Amon and Moav. Bilam quotes that pasuk. Don't inquire their welfare all the days of your life. Amalei, he turns to Bilam and he says, once we're at it, Dine dahu gavre b'mai. What are they punishing you with? Amalei b'shichva zerere tachas. With hot, simmering, boiling, procreative seed. Mefarshim explained, because Bilam is the one who instigated and enticed the entire affair of Benois Midian, of the daughters of Midian, in Parshas Balak and Parshas Pinchas, which resulted in one of the greatest moments of Jewish moral destruction, which almost decimated them. When the Jews engage in harlotry with the daughters of Midian and Moab, so this was the result for Bilam. Azal aske li Yeshu b'negida. Who does now Unculus bring up? He brings up Yeshu. Yeshu, Isaya ish yashke. Now, in the editions of the Gemara, it says Poishe Yisrael, which means Jewish sinners. But really it said Yeshu. They just changed it to the Jewish sinners. He brought up Yeshu. Amalei asks Yeshu, Man Choshev Bahu Alma. Who's Choshev? Who's prominent in that world? What does he mean in that world? In the world where everything is seen completely for its truthfulness? There's no cover-ups. There is no disguise, there's nothing that's camouflaged, where you see reality for what it is. Amala Yisrael, the Jewish people. Ma'alat buki buhu, should I connect to them? Amalai, Yeshu says, Toivasam droish ra'asam loy sidrash. When you're talking about the Jewish people, always search and look to be good to them. Never to do any harm. Because somebody who touches a Jew, it's like he's touching the apple of God's eye. The apple of God's eye, the most sensitive, delicate, precious dimension of the eye. If you touch a Jew, you're touching Bavas Eini, that's what you're dealing with. Amalei, he turns to Yeshu and says, Dinei Dahu Gavri B'mai. Now tell me a little bit about the action. How is your barbecue coming along? What are you being judged? Amalei, Yeshu tells him, B'tsoyerei Tachas. Well, gets you an interesting, you get, Tsoyerei Tachas, Bilam is Shechvazerei Tachas. He's Tsoyerei Tachas, which is what? Which is simmering, boiling, hot excrement. Thank you. Human fertilizer. Or fertilizer. Damar Mar. And he right away gives him a source, because the master said, somebody who mocks and scoffs on the words of the sages is judged with hot excrement. Now, what's the idea of tzoyerei tachas versus shichvazerei tachas is beyond the scope of this shiur. I'll just mention one detail, which is explored in the Mefarshim, especially in the world of Torah Sanister. And the difference is, of course, you can't compare shichvazera, the procreative substance, to tzoyah. One is the source of life, and one is the waste that the human body finds completely useless, and therefore the human body, in its magical mechanism of roifich al basar omafli lasis, opens up its cavities and releases it because there's no nutritious value to this component. For example, if you come to breakfast this morning and you ate the cucumbers, the tomatoes, the lettuce, that has nutritious value to your body. But if you went to the left side of the table, I don't know if it was the left side of the table, and you engaged in the cheesecake, so somehow your body, which is smarter than you, realizes that there's really nothing in it for me. So very, very little part of it can it convert to something useful for your organism and life, and the rest it rejects. So it's exactly the opposite of shichvazera. Shichvazera is the source of life, it's the procreative substance which creates the fetus, which creates together with the mother's egg, which soya represents the leftovers of the leftovers of the leftovers, which absolutely has no value. And essentially, this reminds us of the Avodah Zarah of Baal Pa'or, which is also associated with Bilam, where they used to defecate the idolatry. But the point is that in life, one has to make that choice every single day and really every single moment. What am I going to embrace? Am I going to embrace things that have inherent value, nutritious value, physically, emotionally, psychologically, spiritually, in this world and the next world? Or is one going to embrace that which may look exciting and may have a glittering veneer and may have dazzling appeal, but essentially what it is simmering, boiling excrement? But then the Gemara says something absolutely fascinating. Tachazi, come and see. Ma bein poisha Yisrael in neviyei umas ha'olam ovdei avodah zarah. As we would say in Yiddish, zeh fort vos hayidis. Come see the difference between how Yoshke speaks about the Jewish people and how Bilam speaks about the Jewish people. Both make trouble. And both's life have consequences. But look at the difference. He says, stay away from them. And Yeshu says, it's God's bavas einai. It's the apple of Hashem's eye. The Gemara makes that observation. Tachazi, what's the difference? As we all know, Unculus followed the advice of this interesting figure. Not only did he become a Jew, he gave us the Aramaic, most authoritative translation of the Chumash, which Jews still read every single week in Shnaya Mikra Vecha Targum. As we read the Parsha according to the Halacha, we read the Targum Unculus every single week. Which now brings us to the third piece of Gemara in your sources, number 3, Sanhedrin, Daf Mem Gimel, Amud Aleph. Zok Dehelik Gemara. V'hatanya, we learnt. Be'erev ha-Pesach, tlo'uhu li-Yeshu. It was the day before Pesach, when Yeshu was hanged. V'akruz yoytzi l'fon of mem yoyim, koydim shu yoytzi l'sokel al-shekishev. vehisis vehdiachis Yisrael. Kol misha yedeh lo yischus yavoy v'yelamad alav v'lo yimotzu lo yischus v'talu b'erev ha-Pesach. 40 days before he was taken out to be stoned. For what? For the sin of engaging in kishuf and sorcery, and instigating the Jewish people to engage in idolatry and avodah zarah, which the penalty for a mesis is the death penalty. So 40 days before that, they made an announcement and said, if anybody could come and be malamed zchus, give us a convincing argument to extricate him, to have him go out innocent from the court, do it. But that did not happen. And thus on Erev Pesach, Talu b'Erev HaPesach, it says Lisakel, so apparently what it means is, after Skila, there was, they would, at the Mishnah in Sanhedrin, they would hang the person up for a few moments after death, before they were buried, and this happened Erev Pesach. Frag the Gemara, Amar Rula, V'tizbira Barafuchis Chusu, Mesis Uvrachman, Amar Leisachmo, V'Leisachas Olav. Isn't there one exception? Every single person who commits even a capital punishment, even capital sin, there's an obligation to search for any possible defense besides a mesis, somebody who instigates the public to engage in avodah zarah. Says the Gemara, Shiny Yeshu, the Karev L'Malchus Hava. Yeshu was different because he was so close to the government, to the Malchus, to the royalty. And therefore, it would be extremely dangerous if there was no attempt to create a defense. Tana Rabbanan, Chamisha Talmidim Hayu Loyli Yeshu. He had five students, Masoi, Nakoi, Neitzer, Boni, Vesoida, and the Gemara goes on to describe the conversations that they had with all of these students at that time. So we have a Gemara in Soita, Yeshua ben Prachya, we have a Gemara in Gittin about Unkelos and Yeshu, we have a Gemara in Sanhedrin about Yeshu's death, capital punishment on Erev Pesach in the 40 days of Limud Zchus earlier. Now, here we come to one of the very well-known and infamous chapters of Jewish history, known as the public debates, which were forced upon Jews during the Middle Ages, where Jewish rabbis, representatives, and sages were forced to debate Christian theologians. Sadly and tragically, but not uncharacteristically, most of these debates were triggered, inspired by Jews who became apostates, who left Judaism and converted. And some of these debates have been recorded almost verbatim. The two most famous debates took place only a few years apart from each other. The first in 1240 in Paris. The second in 1263 in Barcelona and Spain. The representative of the Jews in both debates were two of the greatest sages of the time. These were not just small profile rabbis, two of the greatest sages. The first, Rabbeinu Yechiel, one of the Balei HaToisvos. Rabbeinu Yechiel Miparis, who was one of the scholars of the school of Toisvos from the house of Rashi in France and Germany, which explained the Gemara. He was the Rebbe of Maharami Rottenburg, Rebbe Meir of Rottenburg. He was the Rebbe of Rabbeinu Peretz and many of the other great Rishonim. Rabbeinu Yechiel lived in Paris. The king then was Louis the Ninth. And Rabbeinu Yechiel had a student, you have to understand the pain. Rabbeinu Yechiel had a brilliant student whose name was Nicholas Denon, who converted to Christianity. And Nicholas Denon went to Louis and went to the Pope and instigated this debate, and successfully, as a result of this debate, caused the church to ban the Talmud. And 3 years later, you probably know the story in Tammuz, 3 years later, 1243, 2 years later, the entire, all the books, they filled up 24 wagons of manuscripts of the Gemara, and they were all burnt. And you have to understand, nothing was printed then. So every copy that they burnt was handwritten, copied from another manuscript. And in fact, Torah Shebaal Peh, the text of the Talmud, never mind the commentators on the Talmud, would have been almost completely lost if not for the unique grace of God that some of the Balei HaToisvos left to England, and there was some, of course, the Talmud was in other countries, But that was one of the great tragedies that we recite every year on Tisha B'Av in Kinnis, in a famous piyut, Shali Srufa Va'esh. That debate with Rabbeinu Yechiel Meparis, he was debating his own student. The pressure on Jews to convert to Christianity in the Middle Ages was so enormous that some of the great scholars converted. This is in France, in Germany, and then later in the West, more West, in Spain, later the Inquisition. And as a result of that, Nicholas successfully brought Rabbeinu Yechiel and three other great scholars to the debate, and the entire debate was recorded. Who wrote it? Either Rabbeinu Yechiel or another Jew, a contemporary, records the entire debate. Now, of course, Nicholas brings up all of these Gemaras. What does he want to prove? He wants to prove that the Talmud is a document that mocks, scoffs, rejects, belittles, denigrates, and humiliates Christianity and its founder and their savior, and therefore the entire text of Talmud must be banned by the church for eternity. So he brings the Gemara of Tzoyer Tachas. He says, look what they believe. They believe that Yeshu is being judged in hot excrement. He brings the Gemara of Yeshu ben Prachya. He brings all the Gemaras to show the Jewish attitude to this man, as the Gemara says about Yeshu ben Prachya, that Kishe vehissis vediyeches Yisrael. Comes Rabbi Yechiel of Paris in the debate, and he says, one second, Rabbeisai, you want to learn this Gemara? Let's learn this Gemara. Yeshua ben Prachya is the Rebbe of Shimon ben Shattach. Shimon ben Shattach is the Rebbe of Shmaya and Avtalion. Shmaya and Avtalion are the Rebbes of who? Hillel and Shammai. Hillel and Shammai, the Gemara says, lived 100 years before the Churban Bayis Sheni. So how long did Yeshua ben Prachya live before the destruction of Bayis Sheni? Hundreds of years. Because Hillel and Shammai already are in the century before the Churban. The Churban is around 70, as I told you. 68, 69, 70. Hillel and Shammai live a century before. Their Rebbe is Shmaya and Avtalion. Their Rebbe is Shimon ben Shattach. His Rebbe is Yeshua ben Prachya. Hundreds of years before. According to you guys, when was your Savior born? When was your Messiah born? He was born approximately in the year zero. The year zero is 70 years before Churban Bayis Sheni. It's the end of the era of Hillel and Shammai. Here it says he's a student of Yeshua ben Prachya. Is Vos Haxta in China? He didn't use those words. He didn't say, why are you striking a kettle? But what are you telling me? That this is the Yeshu of your, we're talking about that you worship your Messiah. He's a student of Yeshua ben Prachya. So Rabbi Chiel in Paris says, Shnei Yeshu Hava. There's two different Yeshus. So they say to him, you really believe that? So he turns to them, he says, tell me, every boy named Louis is the king of France? There are no Louis that are not the kings of France? Two people can have the same name and different things can happen to them? Two people can have the same name and they can sometimes have the same fate and the same destiny. But it's two different people. He says, clearly, Yeshua ben Prachya is a different generation. He says, besides, you believe in the crucifixion. He was crucified. What do we have here? We have a different story. Here we have a story of skila, of being stoned. Which, by the way, is very fascinating because the whole idea that Yoshke died as a result of the crucifixion, which is one of the basic doctrines, if not one of the most basic doctrine of Christianity, It originates in what's known as the Gospels, in what they would call the New Testament, which was, so to speak, written in the centuries after the birth of Christianity by students or students of students or students of students of students. And there they have the entire story of how he was crucified before Pesach, Erev Pesach. By whom? By the Roman. It was done under the jurisdiction, under the leadership of a man named Pontius Pilate, who was the governor of Rome in Judea. He was the governor of Rome in Judea, in Eretz Yisrael, in charge of Yerushalayim, between the years 26 and 36 of the Common Era, which means exactly 40 years before the Churban Bayit Sheni. So according to them, when was this man killed? This man was killed 30, 40 years before Churban Bayit Sheni, because Pontius Pilate was a governor between 26 and 36. Churban Bayit Sheni is the year 70. And under his jurisdiction, according to their story, he was crucified. So first of all, the Jews never crucified anybody. They weren't allowed to. It's not one of the systems of death, the methods of death. Jews didn't have a right to crucify. A Jew who would crucify would himself be a murderer. Certainly a Jewish court. So the story of Skila and Tlia is a very different story. By Beis Din is a very different story than the story of the Gospels that they wrote down about crucifixion under the leadership of Pontius Pilate. So Rabbi Chiel Mipariz determines that there are two different Yeshus. There's the Yeshua ben Prachya's student, and there is the one that founded the religion that is called Christianity. 23 years later, in Barcelona, the Ramban is forced to debate publicly none other than another great Jew, a student who became a Meshumad, who converted, and was known as Pablo Christiani. Pablo Christiani, the famous debate of 1263 that the Ramban himself transcribed, and it's printed, known as Vikuach HaRamban. It's a long debate, fascinating debate. I wanted to show you one fascinating piece where the Ramban quotes what he said. Take a look at the next piece. Pablo Christiani opens up a Medrash Rabba Eicha. And what does it say in Medrash Rabba Eicha? On the day that the Beis HaMikdash is destroyed by the Romans, Tisha B'Av, of the year 70, approximately the year 70, there's a Jew in the Judean deserts plowing his field. And his ox grunts. There's an Arab Bedouin who understands the language of animals, and the Arab Bedouin tells the Jew, stop plowing. Your temple was just destroyed. A few moments later, the bull gives another grunt. The Arab says, you could start plowing. Noilad Mashiach Shal Yisrael. Your Savior was just born. Your Mashiach was just born. On Tisha B'Av, seconds after the destruction, your Savior is born. The guy says, look, when was Mashiach born? He was born already. He was born during the time of the Churban Beis HaMikdash. Jews say Mashiach didn't come yet. The Messiah hasn't arrived. We're waiting for the Gula. We're waiting for Mashiach. Look, you have a Medrash clearly that says Mashiach was born, and you know when he was born, and therefore you know who he is. This is what Pablo tells the Ramban. Zog the Ramban. Be'emes, this is his answer. His answer in front of the king of Barcelona, in front of the king Aragon of Barcelona, of Aragon. He says this. Be'emes she'eni ma'imin shenayla da Mashiach b'yom ha'churban. I don't believe Mashiach was born that day. Hagada as it says in Medrash. Oy she'ena emes. Oy she'yesh lapirush acher misisrei hachachamim, misstorei hachachamim. Either it's not true. The Ramban tells them, I'm not obligated to believe everything he says in the Medrash, which is discussed why he said that. That was one way of simply neutralizing that it's not the basis of Jewish doctrine, or it has another mystical interpretation. But you know what? For argument's sake, I'll accept it, exactly as you said, literally. Mashiach was born that day. Rayahili, this is my proof. Hine. I I don't understand. Mashiach was born the day of the Churban. According to you, when was Yeshu born? He was born approximately the year zero. When was he killed? He was killed in his 30s as a young man, right? By Pontius Pilate, under the vigil of Pontius Pilate. So he wasn't born on the day of the Churban. He was already dead. So you want to bring this Medrash? Fine. There's another Mashiach who was born on Tisha B'Av. We're looking for him in the 13th century. But it's not your guy. V'lidasoi karev l'masayim shana koidem ha'churban l'fi ha'emes. And if you want to know the emes, he was born around 200 years before Churban Bayis Sheni. If you want to know the real truth about that Yeshu who you call Mashiach. U'lefi cheshbonoichem ayin gimel shana. And according to your calculation, he was born 73 years before the Churban. In other words, he was born a few years before the year zero. The Churban is the year 70. So he was born when? He was born in the year 3, right? BCE, before the Common Era. He was killed a few decades later. And the Churban happened 73 years after his birth. According to your calculation. The truth is, it's 200 years before. He's probably referring to the Gemara about Yehoshua ben Prachya. So he's saying he actually lived a few centuries earlier. And the Ramban says, "Oz nishtatek ha'ish." So the man was silenced. This gives us just a little taste of a long vikuach, both of Rabbi Chiel Mepariz of the Ramban and many other vikuachim, that Rabbi Yehuda David Eisenstein compiled in his famous work, known as Oitzer. What is it called? Oitzer ha'vikuachim, the treasure of disputes and debates, where Eisenstein, Zichrono Levracha, brings all of these debates of Rabbi Chiel Mepariz, the Ramban, and many more. Here you see how the Ramban approaches just one detail. On a maestri gila mashayfat hashel melech, the judge under the king responds to me and says, "Eina tahavikuach b'yeshu." Aval hashaylei bar mashiachim loy va'ata amarta shaloy ba va'asefer hazeh shelechem oimer shebo. Clever guy. Forget, we're not debating Yeshu now. Zozayim, he's not Mashiach. But don't you see, you guys say Mashiach did not come. Your Medrash says Mashiach came. That's the debate. Forget who is Mashiach. You say he didn't come. The Medrash says he came, he was born. So this means that your entire doctrine about Mashiach is erroneous, and it's a distortion of real Judaism, because this is what your Medrash says. Amarti loy, I told him. You're choosing, as is usually your custom, to speak deceitfully and slyly. But I'm going to answer you. The Medrash doesn't say Mashiach came already. The Medrash doesn't say Mashiach arrived already. The Medrash says Mashiach was born. The day that Moshe was born, he came to redeem the Jewish people. It took decades and decades. The day he came to Parah and said, "Let my people go," that's the day he's a redeemer. That's the day the process of the Geula came. When Mashiach will come to the Pope, the Ramban says, and says, "Let my people go," that's the day I'll say Mashiach came. Till today he didn't come. V'gam einenu Mashiach kla. And therefore he's not Mashiach. Ki David ha-melech b'yoyim sh'noilad lo'y ha'ya melech v'lo'y Mashiach. K'shamash ch'shmuel ha'ya Mashiach. B'yoyim sh'yim sh'chileyo'o l'mashiach. B'mitzvah ha'kel yikari Mashiach. B'yoyim sh'yavei achere kein la'pifiyar ligaloy sonu az yikari ba. Fascinating words from the Ramban. David, the day he was born, wasn't Mashiach. When Shmuel ha'navi anoints him at the direction and instruction of Hashem, then he's called Mashiach Hashem. Mashiach means anointed. Then he's anointed. Till then he's not anointed. So he says, let's say Mashiach was born. He's not Mashiach yet. He may be the person who's going to be Mashiach. He's just anointed. He's not anointed yet. He's that person who has the potential to be Mashiach. Therefore, the day that Eliyahu HaNavi will anoint Mashiach, and this is what the Ramban says, Eliyahu will anoint him, that's the day you could call him Mashiach. The next day, when he approaches the Pope, that's the day you could say Mashiach came. The day before, you could say he's Mashiach. He didn't come yet. The next day, when he comes to the Pope, you'll say Mashiach came. This is how the Ramban responds to one medrash of Eicher Rabba among the many other sources that they bring. But now they brought another Gemara to Rabbi Yechiel Meparis in his debates, and let's see this next piece of Gemara. Sanhedrin Daf Samach Zayin Amud Aleph. Zog the Gemara. V'chein Asu Leben Sdada Belud. This is what they did. What does it mean? This is what they did. The Gemara and the Mishnah speak there about the fate of a Masis, somebody who instigates Jews to engage in idolatry. There was a man, Ben Stada, and they hung him up. They hung him in Lud, Erev Pesach. Talub Erev Pesach. Freg the Gemara, Ben Stada? This man's name was the son of Stada? Ben Pandirayahu. Ben Pandiro, sorry. He's the son of Pandira. He's not the son of Stada. Amr Abchizda, Baal Stada, Boyel Pandira. Meaning, he was the son born from an immoral relationship. His mother's husband was Stada. But the person she had relations with, his name was Pandira. So he's called Ben Stada because he was raised in the house of a man named Stada. But that wasn't really his father. His father was Pandira because his authentic father was somebody who had relations with his mother in an immoral fashion. Freg de Gemara, really? Baal? Her husband was Stada? Papas ben Yehuda? We all know that story. Her husband was not Stada, her husband was Papas. And you're calling him Ben Stada. And then you say Ben Pandira. So what happened? How many fathers can a person have? Zog de Gemara, Ela Eima, Imoy Stada. You know what? It's his mother. His mother is Stada. Her husband is Papas Ben Yehuda. His real father is Pandira, another guy. But his mother was Stada. Freg de Gemara, really? Imoy? Miriam! His mother was Miriam, Megadla Neshaya Havai. This is Miriam, it's not Stada. And for the Gemara, Kadamri Bepumpadissa, Sotas Dame Baila. Her name was Miriam. They called her Stada from the word Sotis. She went astray. She left. She separated from her husband, Papus, and engaged in other relations with Pandira. And this is Ben Stada. And he's hung on Erev Pesach. This is also a piece of Gemara that was taken out. He is hung on Erev Pesach, according to Sanhedrin Memzai, Samach Zai. Now, we have another Gemara about the same character. We're Shabbos Kuvdal Ramad Beis. The Mishnah discusses there the fact that one of the 49 malachas on Shabbos is Kosev. You're not allowed to write, right? Writing is a biblical prohibition on Shabbos. You're liable to being a carbon. What about if somebody takes a thorn and scratches letters on their flesh? So there's a machloikis. What's the machloikis? Rabbi Eliezer says they're liable. The person is chayav achatos if it's inadvertent. Chachamim say you're not liable. Amar leh Rabbi Eliezer lechachamim. Rabbi Eliezer turned to the chachamim and said, why are you not liable? You say, why not? You're scratching out letters on your flesh. So why is that not a form of writing? The handwriting will endure. It's not something that won't endure. It's not like when there's it's a ksav that's not miskav. It will endure. Sure, the heat of the body will ultimately cause it to dissolve, but that's like erasing it later. That's what Rabbi Eliezer says. So why do you say that you're not chayiv? I'll tell you a story. Haloi ben Stada hoitzik shofim in Mitzrayim besrita shal psara. Ben Stada took out sorcery, black magic from Egypt by scraping the texts on his flesh. Rashi says, in Egypt there were certain cult practices of black magic. They didn't let anybody leave with them. And at the border, they would inspect you from head to toe to make sure you're not taking it out. So what did Ben Stada do? Sarat. He scraped out, he scratched his flesh with all the codes he needed, and that's how he got out of Egypt. So what does Rabbi Eliezer prove from here? That people do it, and since they do it, it's a form of writing, you should be liable. Amrulai, they told him, Shaita haya, ve'ein v'yinayim in ha-shaita. This man was a fool, he was an imbecile, he was meshuga. Rashi says, why was he meshuga? He says, because they could kill you. To sacrifice your life, to take out these coats from Egypt, you got to be crazy. What's the point? The point is, it's not derech melacha. It's not the way people do things. It's a bizarre way of writing. And since it's a bizarre way of writing, so it's like any melacha of Shabbos. If you do it in a bizarre way, what we call kala achar yad, biblically you're not liable, right? If you carry out something in your mouth, if you carry out a laptop on Shabbos in your mouth, I mean, you could carry it in your mouth, but it's a bizarre way of doing it. It's not a piece of food. So biblically, you're not liable. This is a bizarre way of writing. You don't scratch things. There's people I see, Tucker, sometimes when they don't have paper, they'll write things on the... you probably saw it, right? But you're not using a pen. You're not taking a thorn and scratching out letters on your flesh. And therefore, you're not liable. Frag the Gemara, Ben Stada, here we go again. Ben Pandira, he's not Ben Stada, he's Ben Pandira. So the Gemara goes through the whole thing, right? Her husband was Stada, his father was Pandira. Frag the Gemara, no, his mother was Stada, and she's called Stada because Sata's Damebaya. Nicholas Denon comes to Rabbi Yechiel Meparis, his old Rebbe, and he says, look, Louis. They call, Your Majesty, they call Yeshu a shoita. First is Nidoin B'tzayarei Tachas, and now he's a shoita. This is what they call, you have to ban the Talmud. How does he know it's Yeshu? His mother is Miriam, right? His father is Pandira. He's hung Erev Pesach. He's hung on Erev Pesach. He's involved in Kishev. He was in Egypt. So right there in Shabbos, there's a Toisvus, a fascinating Toisvus. The Toisvus was also censored. But now we have the full Toisvus. And in Toisvus Harash, you have it originally the way it is, an accurate text. Look, Toisvus, Ben Sdad, Oimer Rabbeinu Tam. Look what they took out. It's very hard to understand the Toisvus. The Ein Zeh Yeshua Noitzvi. Don't think this is Yeshua Noitzvi. The HaBen Sdad, Amrinan HaChadav, Me Papus Ben Yehuda. This Ben Stada was in the days of Pappas ben Yehuda. It says his mother Miriam was married to a guy named Pappas ben Yehuda. The Havah b'mei Rabbi Akiva, k'demuchah repeated basa the brachas. In brachas daf samachalav amid beis, it says Rabbi Akiva was imprisoned by the Romans. Who did he meet in prison? A man named Pappas ben Yehuda. V'yeshu hoya b'mei Yeshua ben Prachra, k'demuchah repeated basa the soita daf mem zayin. V'loi k'rabbi Yeshua ben Prachra shadachal Yeshua noitzi b'shtei yadayin. V'rabbi Yeshua avakadim tuvel Rabbi Akiva. The Gemara in Soita says Yeshua was in the time of Rabbi Yeshua ben Prachra. Yeshua ben Prachra lived before Rabbi Akiva centuries. Pappas ben Yehuda is a contemporary of Rabbi Akiva. Ben Stada is the days of Pappas. It can be Yeshua Noitzu, who belongs to the milieu, to the era of Rabbi Yeshua ben Prachya. This is the argument of Rabbeinu Tam, and therefore, don't confuse this with that. Rabbeinu Yechiel Meparis said something very similar. He said, one second, this man, Ben Sadada, is Pappas ben Yehuda, Rabbi Akiva's generation, who lives after the Churban and is killed by the Romans after the Churban. According to you, Yeshu is much earlier, even according to your Yeshu. Because Yechiel and Paris doesn't say like Toisvus. He holds that the Yeshu of Yeshua and Prach is completely a different person. And therefore, it's completely not the same person. Besides the fact, your guy's father's name wasn't Pandira. Besides the fact, do you believe he was killed in Lud? It says Lud. You say in Yerushalayim. You still go to a place in Yerushalayim that you say he was crucified there. And therefore, there's absolutely no association with this Gemara. And Rabbeinu Yechiel Meparis proves, he thought he proved, that the Talmud should not be banned. So at Geholfen, Avtoita Bankus, as I told you later, sometime later, they banned it and they burnt everything. Now, this is step one. There's another few stories. There's another Yerushalmi where the name is mentioned. Another story, but let's for now remain with what we have. The Rambam has a letter known as Igeres Teimon. There, the Rambam addresses Christianity as well. As you know, the Rambam believed, unlike other Rishonim, one of the fascinating debates, if Christianity is considered Avodah Zarah for the non-Jew. The Rambam holds it's considered idolatry, meaning the non-Jew is not allowed to follow the faith of Christianity. However, many Rishonim disagree with the Rambam, including Lahalacha, the Ramah, in Ohr Chaim Simen Kufnun Vav, brings the shit of the other Rishonim, Rabbi Yeruchim and many others, who say no, that the Bnei Noach are not Mitzuva al Hashituf, meaning they're allowed to believe in God even if they create a partnership between God and another deity. For the Jew, it's Avodah Zarah. For the Ben Noach, Shituf is not forbidden. So if he's Meshatef Shem Shamayim V'Dover Acher, if he believes like the Christian in what they call the Trinity, Emunas Hashilush, there's a Trinity, but they also believe in God as the creator of the Lord. So according to many Rishonim, and the Ramah brings it lahalacha, as I said in Simen Kuf Nun Vav, it's mamish not considered Avodah Zarah, which according to the Ramah has many ramifications halachically today, that the Christian is not called on Avodah Zarah. The Muslim, the Rambam writes at length, is not Avodah Zarah at all, even if it's erroneous. Christianity, he holds yes, but the Ramah and many poskim say it's not Avodah Zarah, and therefore the criteria we speak about Avodah Zarah, about doing business with Avodah Zarah, engaging with Avodah Zarah, etc., doesn't apply at all to the Christian, according to that sheet of many poskim la'alacha, that the Ben Noach is not Mitzuvah ala Shituf, and therefore Christianity is completely legitimate, even according to the Sheva Mitzvah Bnei Noach. The Rambam, however, writes in the Geres Tema, it is Avodah Zarah, and he says, Yeshu Anoitzri, his father was a Goy, his mother was a Jew. The Gemara says in Yavam, as many of you are learning now, that what? Bas Yisrael, right? Habal, Agoy, Havlat, Kosher. The Jew, the child is a Jew. So he says he was a Jew. He says that Yeshu Anoitzri declared himself as Mashiach. He said that he wanted to change and nullify the whole Torah and mitzvahs. He said that he was a prophet, and therefore it was destroying the Torah. It was Avodah Zarah. We'll soon see what the Rambam says, halachically what happened. This was the Rambam shit. Today, there are many historians who ask if Yeshu HaNoitzri ever lived. Did he ever live? Others argue that the entire source of his life and death comes from the Christian Gospels of what they call the New Testament, that was written centuries after his supposed death by people who were completely biased, because they were followers or disciples of the faith of Christianity, and therefore there's no outside objective force to source to even determine his existence. The sources in Gemara that he did exist, as we see, are highly, highly debatable, which Yeshua it is. Rabbeinu Yechiel Meparis completely dismisses it. The Rambam in Igeres Taman says did exist. The Ramban puts him at the era of Yeshua ben Prach. That there was a Yeshua who existed is not a question. That the Gemara calls him a Noitzri, that he came from Nazareth, is not a question. That the Gemara says that this man Yeshu was involved in Kishuf and Hesus Eidiach is not a question. That he was killed by Bezdin, according to the Gemara, is clear. But who that is and when he lived, that's very difficult to know. And therefore some say that maybe the Jesus of Christianity never existed, or existed at another time, or had a different type of life story. And this is debated ad hayoyim hazeh, and it's certainly not my role or expertise at all to weigh in on that subject. But there's no question that many, many, even objective authorities will speculate that perhaps he did exist, although it may be completely disconnected with the Yeshu that the Gemara discusses. Rabbeinu Yechiel Meparis argued that the story with Tzoyer Reitachas is a different Yeshu. It's the Yeshu of the Gemara, it's Yeshua Beprachi's Yeshu, and therefore it's not an insult to the Christian deity as discussed earlier, Rabbeinu Yechiel Meparis. Perhaps the greatest, most revolutionary Chiddush novelty came from a very surprising source, Rabbi Yaakov Emden. Rabbi Yaakov Emden was born in 1698, same year like the Baal Shem Tov, actually, in Germany. And Rabbi Yaakov Emden, who was a prolific writer, author, scholar, is well known for the fact that he was the greatest zealot of his generation against any vestige containing the false containing the sect that followed the false Mashiach Shapsi Tzvi. Shapsi Tzvi, who declared himself together with his spokesman Nassan as a Mashiach, and created one of the mass revolutions in the Jewish world because much of Jewish Europe believed him and followed him. Shapsi Tzvi, who was from Turkey and declared himself as Mashiach and was a mystical person, extremely mystical, extremely bright, very interesting. Some people say he suffered from a profound mental illness, mental challenge, and had a very talented spokesman, a PR man, Nassim HaZassi, Nathan from Gaza, shook the Jewish world. It's not spoken much today of, but many of the great rabbis of the time believed Shapsi Tzvi. They embraced Shapsi Tzvi. The Jews of Turkey and so many other countries around were intoxicated by Shapsi Tzvi. But then in 1666, he converted to Islam. And when Shapsi Tzvi converted to Islam, you can imagine the sense of disappointment, the breakdown that it caused in the Jewish world, which immediately resulted in a very heavy backlash against Kabbalah, because Shapsi Tzvi was a Kabbalist, a mystic. And the rabbis felt that this is what mysticism can do to people, and therefore let's go back to Halacha, stick to Halacha without Kabbalah. But most Jews realized if he converted to Islam, so then he's not a Messiah, he's not a Mashiach. Shapsi Tzvi made the famous bracha on Tisha B'Av, Baruch Atah Hashem Elokeinu Melech HaOlam, Matir Isurim. And he ate on Tisha B'Av because when Mashiach comes, the fasts are nullified. When Shapsi Tzvi converted to Islam, most Jews sobered up. But there were those who continued to follow Shapsi Tzvi and say that the real Mashiach has to become a Muslim, because he has to go down into the lowest klipos and extricate the sparks, and that's how redemption can come. And you may know that till today in Turkey, there's still a little sect that follows Shapsi Tzvi, the Shapsayim. But in the century after, there were still Jews who followed him. And Rabbi Yaakov Emden made it his mission statement to uncover them and remove the disguise. And one of the people he suspected, as you know, was Rabbi Yonis and Apeshitz, and for decades, not only the Jews of Germany, but many other European countries were rattled by a terrible, terrible machloikas between Rabbi Yaakov Emden and Rabbi Yonis and Apeshitz, although Rabbi Yonis and Apeshitz's innocence was ultimately and clearly determined. And that's why I say it's so surprising that Rabbi Yaakov Emden, who has a commentary on Megillus Tainus, on Seder Olam Rabbe Zutta, which discusses Jewish history, makes a unique and quite surprising comment about Yoshka and about Christianity. What Rabbi Yaakov Emden says, I should really put it in the source that we post, because it's not posted in this source, but I'll read it to you. Rabbi Yaakov Emden says, when somebody reads the Gospels, one sees that Yoshka, so to speak, preached to his students that I did not come to nullify any mitzvahs, and I did not come to change anything in the Torah, which is often quoted by missionaries, Jews for Jay and others, when they try to persuade Jews. Sometimes at my lectures years ago, there were people in the crowds that would get up and start discussing visions that they had from God and from the, so to speak, and they told me what to do and to convert. And so I asked a colleague, how do you deal with it? So he said that years ago he had it with Hare Krishnas, and the way he dealt with it was, you look the person in the eyes for 30 seconds, you don't say a word, you just gaze them in the eyes, and then with an unwavering look you tell them, God revealed himself to me, and he told me not to talk to you. And that's it. Usually, that solves the problem, you know. You know not. You know that God didn't tell me last night not to talk to you. And that was it. God speaks to you, he speaks to me, and it's all wonderful. So Rabbi Yaakov Emden, he tells his students, Yeshu tells his students, I did not come to change anything from the Torah. On the other hand, in other parts, you have him mocking the sages and the Pharisees, right? The famous expression, it's not important what you take into your mouth, it's important what comes out of your mouth. The focus should be Ben Adam L'Chaver, not Ben Adam L'Mokim. The Jewish religion became corrupt because it's all focused on man and God, not man and his fellow Jew. And he's developing a faith that focuses on social justice and love and camaraderie, etc. Which parenthetically they say that Rabbi Yaakov Emden was once asked by one of the great Christian sages or kings at the time, why is it that the Old Testament, your Torah, is filled with descriptions of God as jealous, as a Ish Milchama, a God of war, a God of vengeance, a God of punishment, Kel Nekamas Hashem, Kel Nekamas Sefiah, and the New Testament, God is all about love. So Rabbi Yaakov Emden, so they say, responded and said, I'll explain it to you. In our tradition, we say, when it comes to hate, when it comes to vengeance, when it comes to war, when it comes to zealotry, when it comes to revenge, this is God's job. This is God's job. What's our job? Our job is to love, to embrace, to respect. He says, you guys say, God is love, 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 love. So who does all the hating? Who does all the killing? Who does all the murdering? Who does all the abusing? He says, that's left for you. Look what you're doing to us for thousands of years already. So Rabbi Yaakov Emden's response. So the Rambam, who knew about this, obviously, he writes clearly in the Negeres Tema that Yeshu came to nullify Torah and mitzvahs. He said, I didn't. But the Rambam is aware of the inherent numerous contradictions within the Gospels, within what they call the New Testament. And therefore the Rambam's position was, he declared himself Mashiach, he declared himself a prophet, he said that God revealed himself the truth of the Torah, and ultimately the objective was to change Halacha, to change the Torah, which is what Christianity did, obviously. Rabbi Yaakov Emden proposes a very different idea. Rabbi Yaakov Emden says, and these are Mamish's words, I translate. He says, to the Jews, he came, and he told them, don't change anything of Torah. I don't want to change anything of Torah. You have to keep the Torah, you Jews. All the statements where he changes Torah and he focuses on different ideas, he says because he came with a second mission to the Gentiles. And his mission to them was, Sheva Mitzvahs B'nai Noach. You keep the Sheva Mitzvahs B'nai Noach. And he said he was successful. He uprooted pagan idolatry and pagan immorality from the Gentile culture. And he says, look at the positive revolution he created. For the Jews, he said, don't touch Torah. For the Gentile world, he took them away from barbaric paganism and he made them embrace the Sheva Mitzvahs B'nai Noach, which are the basic moral codes known as the seven Noachide laws that God gave the Adam and the B'nai Noach for all of humanity. And in that sense, Rabbi Yaakov Emden has this great praise for this individual who he says came with a very noble mission to tell the Jews to strengthen Torah and to tell the Gentiles that their role is to observe the Sheva Mitzvahs B'nai Noach, believe in God, respect God, follow God, not curse God, not steal, not kill, as this system of the Sheva Mitzvahs B'nai Noach, which is obviously a very fascinating theory or idea of Rev Yaakov Emden. Now, some of you, it's not popular today, some of you have, as children maybe, still remember a book called Toldos Yeshu, or Toldos Oysei HaIsh, that Jews used to read on the night of Nittel. The night of Nittel, and in many communities they don't learn Torah, which is a whole separate issue, how that happened, why that happened, what's the reason, what's the legitimacy for it, what's the source of it. So they would often read that book. And that book has a whole story about him, which became very well known in Jewish pop culture. you know, his mother was Miriam, and she had another relation, and he was a mamzer, and his father was Yosef, or Yochanan, and he went to the Beis HaMikdash, and he got Kishif, he learned Kishif, and he was flying with the Shema Mefirish, and then they got him down, and ultimately they killed him. All these stories. What's the source of all these stories? Rabbi Yehuda David Eisenstein says he doesn't believe there's historical valid sources for it. It was developed in the 1000s or the 11th century, especially when all the debates with the Christians happened, and some Jew created this book to give a Jewish version for Jews about the history of Yashka. However, it's interesting that the story in the Gemara Shabbos about Ben Sdada or Ben Pandira has some of those elements, where he took Kishif from Egypt, he was hung on Erev Pesach, even though, as we see, Rabbeinu Tam believes that that's not Yeshu HaNoitzri. And I should say that the famous Mekubal, the Emek HaMelech, Reb Naftali Hirtz, famous Mekubal, writes in Emek HaMelech that Yeshu HaNoitzri did Kishif, and he learned it from Yehoshua ben Prachya, his Rebbe. That's what the Emek HaMelech says, that he heard from the Mekubal. Okay, now, we go to part two of this class, and part two of this class is going to explore some of the ideas concerning this person and Christianity in the works of Jewish philosophy, in Kabbalah, and then in Chassidus. Before we go there, I'm going to tell you one fascinating incident that just shows how the different layers of interpreting something. There is a fascinating Baal HaTurim and a fascinating commentary of Reb Chaim Vital that I want to conclude this part with. The Baal HaTurim, you know who the Baal HaTurim was. The Baal HaTurim was Rabbeinu Yaakov Baal HaTurim, who was the son of the Rosh, Rabbeinu Osher, lived in the 1300s, in the 13th century and 14th century, 1200 and 1300, they were born in Germany, and then moved to Spain. His monumental contribution to Jewish scholarship is, of course, the tour, where he organized halacha into the four sections of Ohr Chaim, Yoyredei, Evan Ezer, Choshen Mishpat, and compiled and organized all of the halachas available till his day. And of course, the Shulchan Aruch that every Jew uses till today follows the structure of the Baal HaTurim, Rabbeinu Yaakov Baal HaTurim, who passed away, I believe, in 1340 in Spain on Yud Beis Tammuz. Reb Chaim, yeah? When did the Baal HaTurim pass away? 1340? Okay, if he's maskim, then it's right. I think on the 12th of Tammuz, and this is Rabbeinu Yaakov, but he wrote a commentary on Chumash. The Baal HaTurims in many Chumashim are abbreviated Baal HaTurims. It's not the full commentary. The Baal HaTurim was a very, very poor man. He writes in Turah Rechayim Hilchah Shabbos, I think Reish Mem Beis, it's fascinating and sad. He said, I came to my father, the Rosh, and I asked him a kasha. The Gemara says, "Asei Shabbat chachol va'al tetzarech labrius." Right? Make your Shabbos mundane, but don't make yourself dependent on people. Don't make yourself dependent to take tzedakah, charity. Better to have a cheap, simple, mundane Shabbos like a weekday, as far as food, but don't al tetzarech labrius. So Taitch from the Toldos Yaakov Yosef, Moiridik, Asei Shabbat Chechoel, if you'll bring Shabbos into the weekdays, Al Tetzarech Lebrius, you won't need anybody a whole week. You won't feel dependent on people and scared of people. So the Baal HaTurim came to the Rosh, and he said, I have a kasha, what about me? I need people a whole week. A whole week I need people to eat. So could I make my Shabbos, because I anyway need people. In other words, somebody who's tetzarech labrius, you're anyway going to take from people. Because I can't survive even on a simple meal without it. So can I take more money for Shabbos in order to make a luxurious Shabbos? And he says, my father didn't give me an answer. But it explains to you the poverty which this person had. We read the tour today, we often don't realize this. We learned the tour, but he writes this. The Baal HaTurim has a commentary that has perturbed Jews for many generations. I'm going to quote to you the commentary. I'll post it later in the sources, and it'll be online if you want to see it inside. You have to hear this commentary. It's a pasuk in Parshas Re'eh. Moshe Rabbeinu says, "Ki yakum bekir b'cha navi oicholim chalayim v'nasan elecha oisay moifus." A prophet among you will rise up and give you a wonder. He'll make a miracle, and the miracle is going to happen. And the message of this navi is, "Let's go worship other gods." So leisishmal divrei hanavi Yahu, don't listen to him. God is testing you. Do not obey that navi. Don't obey that navi. The Baal HaTurim has a comment. Bekir b'cha, ki yakum bekir b'cha navi, a navi will rise among you, says the Baal HaTurim, bekir b'cha begimatria zu ha'isha. The numerical value of the word bekir b'cha is, this is the woman. What in the world? Bekir b'cha, what's bekir b'cha? Bekir b'cha is... Kuf Reish is 300, right? Chaf is 320. Beis and Beis is 4. 324. The same numerical value as the words Zu Ha'isha. This is the woman. 324. What is the Baal HaTurim saying? Ki Yakum Bekir B'cha Navi. A Navi will rise. He'll make a miracle and he'll tell you, let's go to Avodah Zarah. Don't listen to him. He resurrects the dead. He walks on water. I don't care. I don't care if he feeds 5,000 people with 2 pieces of sushi. If he's telling you Avodah Zarah, that's the halacha. You don't listen to him, even if there's a miracle. The famous Rambam in Hilchos Yesodei HaTorah, which discusses this at length. Perek Zayin, Perek Ches, Perek Tes. But what's the connection to a woman, Zu Ha'isha? Very strange. So somebody once said, I saw it even quoted in the name of Rabbi Akiva Eger, although I didn't see it in the source, that the Baal HaTurim wrote something else. He didn't write Zu Ha'isha. There was a censorship. We read Bekir B'cha Zu Ha'isha. What he really wrote was Bekir B'cha Navi B'gematria Zu Ha'isha Ubna. Bekir B'cha Navi Zu Ha'isha Ubna. If a prophet among you arises, this is the woman and her son. Of course, that Moshe Rabbeinu was predicting the story of Christianity, where a mother and a son will come together to create this fantastical episode of the belief of Christianity. Zu Ha'isha Ubna. Zu Ha'isha Ubna works with Bekir B'chanavi. You have to add the word Ubna. However, it seemed fascinating to me. However, I did a little more research. And I'm not sure that Pshat and Baal HaTurim, and I'll tell you why. If you look in Sifri, in Dvarim, on Parshas Re'eh, it says, Ki yakum bekir b'cha navi. If like the Sifri, what's the word bekir b'cha? Ki yakum navi, with bekir b'cha. From you, within you. And if it's not from you, if it's from outside, it means a Jew. A Jew. So ki yakum bekir b'cha literally means a Jew. In other words, even a Jew who rises up and he does miracles, says the Sifri that Bekir B'cha is Lerabois Ha'isha. It teaches, it's not only a man, even a woman who gets up and makes miracles and then says, let's go do Avodah Zarah, you would think maybe a woman is different. Women you can trust, women you can believe, says the Pasuk, Bekir B'cha Lerabois Ha'isha. I would say, perhaps, that the Baal HaTurim was showing that the Sifri's comment is not just a far association. Bekir B'cha Zu Ha'isha. That the gematria of Bekir B'cha is the woman, and the Sifri, therefore, is limud, is in the gematria of the word. If that's Pshat and Baal HaTurim, then there's no need to invent and say that it was written Zu Ha'isha Ubna. Although, I saw this brought in the name of Rabbi Akiva Eger, and I saw that somebody wrote that there's an old Chumash they saw with an old Baal HaTurim that Taka said Zu Ha'isha Ubna, but I couldn't find that available in what I researched. However, what is fascinating is Reb Chaim Vital's interpretation. Reb Chaim Vital, you know, was a student of the Arizal. The student of the Arizal. Which means he lived in the 16th century in Tzfas and then Damascus in Syria. Reb Chaim Vital is responsible for giving us most of the teachings of the Arizal during the 2 years when the Arizal taught Kabbalah in Tzfas from Shin Lamed till Shin Lamed Beis. meaning from 1570 till 1572, when the Arizal passed away at the age of 36 or 38, according to different versions, and Reb Chaim Vital transcribed his Torah. Reb Chaim Vital, however, took all the manuscripts with him into his grave. And his son, Reb Shmuel Vital, fascinatingly, opened the grave and took out the Kisvei Arizal and published them. Reb Shmuel Vital. Now, Reb Chaim Vital has his own svarim, interesting svarim. He has fascinating Shari Kedusha. He writes about his own visions, his own prophecies. He has a sefer called Eitz Hadas Toiv. Eitz Hadas Toiv, in other words, not Eitz Hadas Toiv Ra, Eitz Hadas Toiv, the good part of the Eitz Hadas, is a commentary on Chumash. On Parshas Re'eh, Reb Chaim Vital has a commentary on these psukim in Parshas Re'eh, where Moshe discusses the prophet. Reb Chaim Vital says, Moshe Rabbeinu was predicting to the Jewish people that the world will be changed by two people who will claim that they're God's prophets, Yeshu and Muhammad. One will create Christianity, one will create Islam, and they will change the face of civilization. And he says, if you read through the Parsha in Re'eh, where he discusses the false prophets, and you're medayik in each word, it's the story of Christianity and Islam, and Reb Chaim Vital goes through the whole Parsha in Re'eh, that section, and shows the parallels between how Christianity and Islam unfolded, and the words that Moshe Rabbeinu chose. I want to point out a few fascinating details. Moshe Rabbeinu says the words are, Ki yisischa achicha ben imecha. When your brother, the son of your mother, right? The son of your mother, or your son, or your daughter, or your wife, or your friend, will instigate you to do avodah zarah. Don't listen to him. He's a mesis, he's a mediath. Harik targenu, yot chatiya bai v'rishayna la'amisa, kill him. Your hand should be there first to kill him, the one who he instigated. V'yad kalam b'achareinu, skaltoi ba'avonim. This is the din of a mesis b'skillim. Says Reb Chaim Vital, that this parsha speaks about Yeshu HaNoitzri. That's why it says, ki yisischa achicha, your brother. Why your brother? Because he was a Jew. Not like Muhammad, the previous parsha wasn't a Jew. Then he says, Beni Mecha. You know why? Because his mother Miriam was a Jew. But his father, Pandira, was not Jewish. That's why it says, Ki Yisischa Achicha Ben Ami, Beni Mecha. Why doesn't it say Ben Avicha? He says, because it's a remez to Yeshu. His father wasn't a Jew. Ben Ami. Then he says, that the first one, Yishmal, Jews couldn't kill. But him, but Masechta Sanhedrin, it says they killed him. That's why it says, Ki Horek Tahargenu. And then it says, Harik ta'argenu yot chatiya by Barishayna. Barishayna is Erev Pesach, because Chaydash Harishin is Chaydash Nissan. So Barishayna is Erev Pesach, which is Chaydash Harishin. And first he was judged by Sanhedrin, but then Pontius Pilate took him, and that's why it says, V'yad kala omba acharayna yot chatiya by Barishayna, and then Pontius Pilate took him. This is what how the Reb Chaim Vital explains the whole parsha at length in Eitz Hadas Toif. What's interesting is a Yalkut Shemayni, which I put into the sources. Take a look in your source. The next source, Yalkut Shemayni. It's the last source on page 1. It says the Yalkut Shemayni, Reb Elezer HaKapar Oimer, Nosin Alekim Koyach B'Koyli Shul Bilum V'Oyolich Misoif Oilam V'At Soifoy, בשביל שהיה צויפה ורואה סאומס שמשתחבן לשמש, לירח, לגחבם, לעצו, לאבן, וצופה ורואה שיש אדם בן אישה שעושת למד, שמבקש לעשות עצמי, או לקה להטס כל העולם כולו, לפיכך נוסן כוח בכוילה שישמו כל המסוים. The Yalkut Shemayni says the prophecy of Bilam was to the world. He saw there's going to be a man who's going to declare himself God. And on a God, or incarnation of God, and he's going to confuse the world. Therefore, God gave Bilam the strength to speak to the whole world and warn them against this false notion. Comes the Yalkut Shemayni and says that the words of Bilam and Parshas Balak are addressing the Christian faith. V'cheinu oimer, tnu daitchem shaloi litois achar oisa yeish. Don't go astray. Shenemar, what's Bilam's words? Loi ish keil v'yechazev. God is not a man who lies. V'im yoimar shu keil hu mechazev. In other words, lo ish keil, God can't be a person. God is not a human being. If somebody says, I am God and I'm a human being, v'yichazev, know that it's a lie. Lo ish keil v'yichazev. He's going to tell you he's a son of God. Really, he's just a human being. So you should know he's a ben adam v'yisnecha, who makes mistakes. Show asid. The next page, turn it around. Show asid lahatiz v'loimar show mistalik u'balakitzer. Ha'hu amar v'loyasa. He's going to say, second coming. I'm here, I redeemed you, I went away, and I'm going to have a second coming. So Bilam says, Ha'hu amar v'loyasa. Will God tell you he's going to do something and not do it? He's telling you he redeemed the whole world, and the world is full of chaos and bloodshed. This is all Bilam's response. Rama Kosova Yisam Shaliva Yoimer Oimi Yichyam is Sumayel Amar Bilam Oimi Yichyam Oisa Umasha Shama Achar Oisa Isha Osa Atzmalaka. Oi Gewalt, how are we gonna be able to live under the nation which followed this man and decided that he was God? Oimi Yichyam is Sumay Kale from the nation that made him God. Of course, what he's referring to is the fact that in 325, the Roman Empire embraces Christianity as the religion of the New Age. Constantine, the Emperor of Rome, Rome was the quintessential enemy of Christianity. According to the Christian version, it was Rome that killed Yashka. It was Pontius Pilate who crucified Yashka. Not physically him, but under his leadership, under his jurisdiction. And Rome, we know, hunted down the Christians, the early Christians, with an aggression and a brutality that only Rome knew how to do. The amounts of Christians that they crucified over the next decades, during the life of Yashka and after his death, was enormous. But suddenly, 325, which is less than three centuries after the Churban Bayis Sheni, three centuries after Yeshu HaNoitzi was killed, according to their version, according to that story, Constantine has a vision. And in his vision, he meets the founder of Christianity. He also had visions. And suddenly, not only does he embrace it, but now Rome becomes the nation identified with Christianity, which is why Christianity essentially takes over the world. It takes over Europe, and it would rule Europe for close to two millennia. Of course, a few centuries later, in the 600s, a new character arises, which creates the religion of Islam in the 600s, which is Muhammad in Medina, in a different section of the world. And then the world splits between Islam and Christianity, the conflict between Yishmael and Esav. So, miyichyeh misumay kel, how could you live under that nation which saw him as a god? And once that happened, the Jews were accused of killing the God. And once they're accused of killing the deity, so then the anti-Semitism that results as a consequence of that changes the face of Jewish history, because Jews are the killers of Christ, the killers of the deity. And how can you sympathize and tolerate such a people? In fact, there's a great book, Constantine's Sword, that records that history. And one of the stories is, they asked Constantine, should we kill the Jews? He said, no. We'll always need a scapegoat. And this was quite psychologically brilliant, if not corrupt, because it allowed the church for the next 1500 years to cover up almost all corruption and almost all evil by blaming it on the scapegoat, the Jews. If there would be no Jews, he said, what do we do? We're going to have to become introspective. It's like what Israel is today. There's an oil spill in the Gulf of Mexico. There's a problem with global warming. There's problems with Sudan, Syria, Iran, Iraq, Egypt, Libya. And of course, the guilt, the scapegoat is the Sayyid al-Azazel, Israel. So this is the commentary of Reb Chaim Vital, who, again, the idea is that Moshe Rabbeinu was already addressing this. I don't know if you know, there's one sefer of Igros Moshe that was printed after Reb Moshe passed away. Reb Moshe Feinstein, Zatzal, passed away, Tainus Esther, Tovshin Mem Vav, 1986. The eighth volume of Igros Moshe was published by his family after that. The introduction to the eighth volume of Igros Moshe contains a beautiful and interesting biography of Reb Moshe Feinstein. And there, the family records a story that they heard from Reb Moshe Feinstein himself. Reb Moshe used to be a Rav in Luban, Lubano was a city in Russia. His father was a Rav, Reb David, and then he was a Rav, and then he fled Russia and ultimately came in the 30s here to the U.S. and settled in the Lower East Side, founded Masifta Teferis Yerushalayim, etc. Reb Moshe told a story that happened in Luban, and he wanted to convey the fact that there were Jews, Balabatim, in other words, ordinary Jews, and yet, it's mind-staggering what type of people they were. And he said, this is Reb Moshe's story, in Igros Moshe, Chelek Ches, in the intro, you could look it up. Reb Moshe says, one day he got a message that a balabas in Luban, a community member in Luban who he knew very well, asked him to come see him. He came to see him. The man was extremely sick. He developed a terrible illness in his mouth, a terrible infection in his tongue, and he was extremely ill. And he tells Reb Moshe, I called you here because I want to tell you a story. Last Friday night, Parshas Vayera, I was sitting at my Shabbos table. And what's the story of Vayera? One of the stories, after the destruction of Zdoim, Lot escapes with his two daughters into a cave. They don't believe that there's any man around and the world is going to come to an end. They intoxicate their father and they have relations with him. Both of them become pregnant. One has a baby who she names Moav, the other has a baby who she names Ammon. And they are the father of the two nations, Ammon and Moav. I'm sitting at the table and I'm discussing the despicable behavior of Bnois Lot. Which daughter does this? Under the most dire circumstances, to make your father drunk, to be able to have physical relations with him. And I spoke extremely negatively about their repulsive, abominable, ridiculous, notorious, and immoral behavior. That night, Friday night, he tells Reb Moshe, I went to sleep. In my sleep, I have a dream. In the dream, I see two women show up. They're dressed in white, and they're covered in white. They introduce themselves, and they say, we are the daughters of Lot. We heard your conversation at the Shabbos table. And we want to tell you that you really don't get it. You really don't comprehend the whole story. And I want to give a little intro to, I think, which will help us appreciate what he saw in the dream. It is a fascinating story for sure, but it's even more fascinating that the Torah records that story in detail so that we have to know exactly what the daughters of Lot did in that cave, although it's not really relevant to the story that Bereishis develops, which is the story of Avraham Avinu and Yitzchak and Yaakov. It will one day become relevant, perhaps, if you want to explain why the Torah says Lo Yavei Amoni Umayavi Bekal Hashem in Parshas Kisetze, because it begins in this way, the nation, although that's not the reason the Torah gives. It will become relevant in the book of Rus, in the book of Rus, hundreds and hundreds of years later, because Rus is a Moabite princess, she marries a Jewish boy, a Jewish man. Ultimately, she converts. She marries a man named Boaz. They have a son named Oved, who has a son named Yishai, who has a son named David. And the entire dynasty of Jewish royalty and monarchs come from who? From David, which comes from Rus, which comes from Moav, who is a child that was born from the relation of Lot and his daughter. And Mashiach is going to be Mizera David Ushleima, which means the future ultimate redemption of the Jewish people through Mashiach is traced back to this relation between Lot and the daughter. And that's why it's brought in Parshas Vayera. It becomes a very important story, because when it says Nechaye Me Avinu Zera, what does the Medrash say? Who's the Zera? It's Zera Melech HaMashiach. And when it says Bnois Zdoim Hanim Tzoyis Be'ir, says the Medrash Hanim Tzoyis is Matzosi David Avdi B'Shem and Kotshi M'Shachtiv Fregen Chazal Heichem Matzosi. Where do you find him? B'Zdoim. I found David in Zdoim in that moment when Lot and his daughters connect, because Moav is the father, the Zayd of Rus, who is the Baba of David, who is the Baba, who is the Zayd of Mashiach. So now back to the dream. The Bnois Lot come and they say, you really don't understand what happened. what really happened. We knew that one day a Jew is going to rise up in the world, and the world will embrace him as their Messiah. And the story they're going to develop is that his mother had him as a baby. And who was her husband? Her husband was none other than the Ribbono Shel Olam b'Chvoido b'Atzmai. Immaculate conception. This was not a conception from a bus of Adam. This is a conception from the Holy Spirit, from the divine. And therefore, this baby is not a regular human being of flesh and blood who has a father and a mother. This baby is, so to speak, kevayachal, godly, in God incarnate, an incarnation of God, kevayachal. We knew that this is going to happen. We knew that it's possible to happen. We knew it's going to happen. And therefore, we decided to do something. We also became pregnant from our father. When people saw that we're having a baby, you know what we could have said? We could have said, you know where this baby comes from? Immaculate conception. There's no man in the world. God impregnated us. And people would believe us. If they believe him, or his mother, or his students, why shouldn't they believe us? They know how many miracles light had. They know how many miracles Avram experienced. They know how many miracles we had in escaping Zdayim. So another miracle. God impregnated us. We decided to put ourselves to shame. And I named my son Moyav, Me'av, because we wanted to tell the world there's no such a thing as conception without a father and a mother. There's no child without a tata and a mama. We wanted to teach the world that if somebody comes and says there was an immaculate conception, they should know it's a fallacy, and that's why we would never rely on it. We wanted to make a case and show and publicize it, and that's why it was publicized in the Torah, so people should know the truth. And then they told this man, if you were wondering why we have the schus that Mashiach comes from us, Melech HaMashiach, you would think his origin should be ultimate purity. No, his origin is an erva, an immoral relation between a father and a daughter, one of the arayis. Why? You know why we have this chus? Because we had Mesiris Nefesh to teach the world about the true Mashiach versus the false Mashiach. We sacrificed our reputation for eternity. Thousands of years later, people like you in Luban sit Friday night and denigrate us. Our story went in and was enshrined in the Torah for eternity. Where people put us down, they denigrate us, they belittle us, they make fun of us. Why did we do it? Because we had Mesiris Nefesh to teach the world to distinguish between the false Messiah and the real Messiah. I should say my brother was once speaking to a bunch of cardinals and was very friendly, but at some point they started to ask some hard questions. Then they turned to him and they said, Rabbi Jacobson, let's ask you a real question. Who is Mashiach? And he knew whatever he says is going to be quite difficult. So he looks at them and he says, one Jew or another. He went out b'shein ve'ayin. I was once at a lecture, somebody started to scream that the chosen people is the greatest racist idea of history. How do you believe such a thing, chosen people? So I looked at him. I said, what faith do you follow? He's a Christian. He was once a galach, even a priest. I said, we're racist. You guys took a simple Jew who was born to a Jew, a father and a mother, and you turned him into God, for heaven's sake. You didn't only say God chose him. You turned him into God. We're the racists. And you have billions of people who believe that this little Jew is God. We know the truth. Every Jewish kid in every Jewish home is told by his mother that he's not only God's gift to humanity, but he's God himself. Most Jews, however, have the great fortune at some point they marry a Jewish wife. And within a few days, or at most a few weeks, if mamash you're lucky, a few months, not only does she explain to you that you're not God or his gift to humanity, but there's even a shaila if you have legitimacy to exist. So that solves all the problems of what our mother inculcated in us. Poor Yeshu never married a Jewish wife. He never got married. He never got married, so his mother's message remained, and the world believes him. Like, we're the racists. You took a Jew, you turned him into the creator of the world. This is what you did to a Jew. So the daughters of Lloyd said, we wanted to teach the world the real Mashiach. And because of our Mesiris Nefesh, to defame ourselves and not to cover up and lie, we were zoiche that the real Mashiach comes from us. And Reb Moshe Feinstein says that this Jew felt that the illness that he suddenly got in his tongue and his mouth was because the way he spoke about Benois Lloyd, the daughters of Lloyd. And he continues the story. The man turned around to the other side and he passed away. And this Reb Moshe heard from his mouth, trying to bring out a quality of a balabas in Luban. I believe he was an older man, he wasn't a youngster, but he felt that this was directly associated with the story. So here again, in Parshas Vayeda, you have a prediction, and you have, according to this interpretation of a dream of Bnois Lloyd, this whole Mahalach. Okay, you sat so wonderfully through a long shiur. We're going to take now a break of 6 minutes, not longer, and then we're going to resume part two, exploring the Kabbalistic, Chassidic, and some philosophical aspect. Thank you. Quoted the story from Igris Moshe based on my memory of what I read a few years ago. One of the participants approached me and made a small but very important correction. And I'll tell you what he told me, so that itself is very valuable. He heard the following story from Reb Moshe's son, Reb Reuven Feinstein Shlito. And Reb Reuven told him that once he was sitting with his father, Reb Moshe, at a table, and he was speaking about the daughters of Lloyd, not so respectfully. So Reb Moshe told his son, Reb Reuven, let me tell you a story that happened with me in Luban in the early 20s. And Reb Moshe shared the story. There was one detail of the story that I want to correct. This balabas in Luban, this man in Luban, told Reb Moshe that what he was saying about the daughters of Lloyd was the fact, he was discussing the fact that one of them named the boy that was born Mayav, which as Rashi and Chazal say means from my father, Me'ah, from my father. And his point was this, Mela you do it, because as Rashi says, she really felt there's no other men in the world, and if they're not going to reproduce, the human species will come to an end. Okay, so there is a moral justification perhaps. But why are you publicizing it? What nerve, what audacity, what lack of sensitivity do you have to publicize it? That your son for the rest of his life has to carry around the name Mayav, that he comes from your father, that his father is also his aid. It seems so insensitive, so disgusting. This was what he was saying. And this is what the daughters of Lloyd explained to him, that she, one of them, sacrificed her reputation forever and named this boy the name Mayav so that the story should be publicized far and wide and actually be publicized in the greatest way because it's recorded in Torah and Torah Shebiksav. And as a result of that, people will realize that what she was saying is a boy, even if you don't know who his father is, he has a father, and even if it's a very uncomfortable story, and even an immoral story, but he has a father, rather than believing that there was immaculate conception. So thank you for the correction. And Reb Reuven asked Reb Moshe, what type of Jew was this Jew in Luban? So he says, an emissar erlechayid, he was a truly honest Jew of integrity and of great observance and piety. And I guess not everybody has the daughters of light coming to them in a Friday night dream explaining the meaning behind those extraordinary stories of Torah. They say there was a Yid, a maskil, who came to the Kotzki Rebbe, Chusay Yagin Aleinu, and he says, Rebbe, you know, I don't know why we learn Chumash. These Jews, such rebels, such rabble-rousers, they're always making trouble. Every Monday and Thursday, there's another mutiny against Moshe Rabbeinu. You have the Meraglim, and you have the Misoinanim, and you have Kivris Atayve, and you have Koirach. And you have the Maisa with the stone. I mean, constantly, they're just always revolting. So the Kotzker Rebbe told him, Rebbe Yid, I'll say in Yiddish and then translate. Von Zeyra Avedis, hat der Eberste geschrieben a Teure. Von deinem Mitzvahs wird kein Teure nicht geschrieben werden. Meaning, from their sins, from their transgressions, from their mistakes, God wrote his Torah, his blueprint for life. I'm not sure that from your mitzvahs, a Torah will be written. Which puts things in perspective, and I think the story with Reb Moshe is a fascinating example. Somebody asked about the Last Supper. The Last Supper, what is the Last Supper? Again, in the Christian version, Pesach was the time when Yashka was killed, and therefore he had a Seder, which was the Last Supper. According to the Gemara, even if you want to associate the story of the Gemara with the Christian Yeshu, which, as we said, is far, far from simple, because here you have a story of stoning, here you have a story of crucifixion, but even if you want to associate it, unlike many of the commentators, it happened Erev Pesach. It happened Erev Pesach. It didn't happen on Pesach. As far as I know, the Last Supper doesn't exist in Jewish sources at all, as far as I know. But all I do know is that the Last Supper certainly exists in Jewish culture. Because whenever I see Jews near a meal, especially in hotels for Pesach, for Shabbatons, for Yom Tovim, I always explain to the chefs and to the waiters, don't get insulted or take it personal when you see how they approach the shmuggis boards, because you have to understand that in the psyche of every Jew, every supper may be the Last Supper. And because it may be the Last Supper, he treats it that way. Because the Jew doesn't know what's going to happen tomorrow morning. I don't know, this may be your last breakfast, your last lunch, your last supper. That's our mentality. And therefore, I think it did make its way into Jewish culture, at least on a humorous level in some way. We now come to the next phase of our presentation. And we're going to begin with a shtickel of Reb Tzadik. We have a copy here. Reb Tzadik HaKoyen of Lublin, whose Sfarim have in recent years gained some popularity, as you know, was born a Shtarke Litvak. He was a fierce Lithuanian Jew from the world of what's known as the world of the Misnagdim, the world that opposed Chassidim and Chassidus. Yet Reb Tzadik has been through a lot in his young years, and a tragic story which is beyond the realm of today's shir, where he decided he wants to divorce his wife, and she did not want the divorce. She felt it was unfair, and he relied on a heter meir rabbanim. He went around to 100 rabbis to receive a heter to be able to marry another woman without divorcing the first wife. It was the Gerer Rebbe, the Chidushi Harim, I believe, who would not sign on the heter and told him to go back to his wife. His wife worked for her father, who had a wine store. Reb Tzadik was a parush, he was an ascetic, he was completely segregated from materialism. And he was a genius par excellence, he was a gon. And lots of people would come to buy from the wine store. And rumors, apparently false, went out about his wife, and Reb Tzadik demanded a divorce. She was an innocent lady. The Chidushim told him not to do it. Reb Tzadik went ahead with it. He married somebody else. He never had children. And he said at the end of his life, it's because he hurt he hurt his first innocent wife. So Reb Tzadik never had children. But when he went to these 100 rabbis for his heter, he encountered the world of Chassidim and Chassidus. Particularly Reb Leibel Eger, grandson of Reb Yakiva Eger, who became a Kotzke Chassid, the author of Teres Emes, who brought him to the Ishbitzer Rebbe, Reb Marder Nemei HaShiloyach. And Reb Tzadik became a fiery Ishbitzer Chassid. After the Ishbitzer's passing, Ishbitz split. Some went to his son Reb Yaakov, the Beis Yaakov, and others went to Reb Leibel Eger, the Teres Emes, to Lublin. Reb Tzadik followed Reb Leibel Eger. After Reb Leibel Eger passed away in 1888, I think, Reb Tzadik became the Rebbe in Lublin. Hence, he's known as Reb Tzadik HaKoyen of Lublin, and he passed away in the year Tofrej Samach, 1900. Reb Tzadik's books are absolutely fascinating works. Fascinating. One of his quite unique books is this one, Machshavas Charutz. And actually, Siman Aleph, the opening Siman, is dedicated, part of it is dedicated to Shapsi Tzvi and Yeshu. It's quite an unusual piece to find in Jewish literature in general, especially in Hasidic literature, which is so focused on the Jew and the Jewish soul and the Jewish responsibility of the Jew to the world. I'm not going to read the whole shtickle, you could read it yourself, and I posted it, we'll have it in the sources. But if you look at the first line, you'll see where he's going. Says Reb Tzadik HaKoyen, HaMachshava Hu Ikir HaAdam Ki Yadua. What's a person? Was is a mensch? Who am I? Says Reb Tzadik. Descartes said, I think, therefore I am. Right? Groucho Marx said, the Jew is invisible, therefore he is. Reb Tzadik says, who is the man? Your thoughts. The truth is, this perhaps could be traced back to the famous teaching of the Baal Shem Tov. The Baal Shem Tov said, "B'makayim shemachshavtoi shel adam sham hu nimtza." Where your thoughts are, that's where you are. Now, this is not a simple idea. In psychology, modern psychology became a very powerful idea. But really, the Baal Shem Tov said it, because let's understand what that means. I'm not there, but my thoughts are there. Practically, what it means is, let's say I'm in a particular situation that is extremely bothersome. Somebody is suffering from depression or addiction or envy or resentment or hatred or other deep psychological, emotional, what we call today, baggage. But my will is to be elsewhere. My thoughts are elsewhere. I want something else for my life. Says the Baal Shem Tov, don't underestimate that. B'makim shemachshavtei shaladam, and in some places it says b'makim sheritzoinoi shaladam, where your thoughts are, where your will is, that is where you are. In other words, ultimately your thoughts define you. We don't think so usually. We say, my thoughts don't define me. My thoughts are just external garments. Because the thought, in Tanya it says that machshava dibur maisa are the garments of the soul, they're not the soul. And yet, the garment has the ability to define you. Because where your thoughts are, that's ultimately where you are. And that's what Reb Tzadik is saying. But there are very many types of thoughts, as he goes on to explore from the Zohar. Now, let's go to column 2. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. 6 lines from the top. The Chet Adam Arishon Hayev Machshava K'mesha Kasev B'Tikuni Zohar. The Tikkuni Zohar says you want to understand the story of the Eitz Hadas. It's not a physical story. Adam Arishon's mistake was a mistake of consciousness, a mistake of machshava, his thoughts. Eating of the Eitz Hadas is a metaphor, according to Kabbalah, for also a metaphor for thoughts. Ein mikra yotze midei pshutoi, but the Tikkuni Zohar explores this at length. V'zehu hadimyon shehichnis by hanachsh. This is the dimyon, the imagination, the thought that the serpent introduced, inserted into Adam's psyche. B'mesha amar v'yisem kelekim yoydei toy v'ra. When he told Chava that you're going to be like God if you eat from the Eitz Hadas, it was a thought. What was it? Ki zeh shoyrish kol hamachshavos shel toyu v'havolim v'dimyonos shebe'adam. L'damos atzmos sheyiyeh be'eizem maila v'inyan sho l'maila mimenu v'she'ein royu lo kol echad kefi asagos. The source of all thoughts of chaos and emptiness and vanity and delusions in a person comes from a person imagining that he is something which he is not. It's not who he is, it's not who he is supposed to be. And yet he creates this imagination that this is who I am. And because of that, the tension that's created between who you are and who you decided you are, or who you think you are, or who you imagine yourself to be or will be, is what creates chaos and delusions in a person's mind. To give a very practical example, I'll give an example from the Tanya, chapter 27, where he says one of the greatest sources of people's anxiety is they decide that they're tzaddikim. And because they decide that they're tzaddikim, when they're confronted by thoughts that are sometimes very, very immoral, they get into a depression, killing themselves emotionally. Look who I am. Look how lowly, look how despicable, which turns them into depressed, melancholy, sad souls. And in the truth is, he says, lots of sadness and depression comes from arrogance. It comes from displaced arrogance, meaning you think you are who you're not. You expect your life to go in a certain way when it's not who you are. You expect yourself to be immune of certain things which there's no reason for you to be immune from. And to the contrary, learn to celebrate the mission that God gave you in living the life that you're supposed to live, not the life that I'm supposed to live, or he's supposed to live, or she's supposed to live. As he puts it there, that sometimes there's people who are created their entire life to struggle with certain instincts, with certain inclinations. He says, don't get depressed. Ulai lekach nivra. Maybe the mission of your life is to battle. Who says not? A Yid came to the Nushina and said he doesn't have time to learn. He's stressed out with work. When he retires at the age of 65, then he'll sit down to learn. So the Nushina said, it says in Pirkei Avos, Al toima l'ksha'ef nash n'shem aloy sipona. Don't say when you'll have time, you'll learn, because you may never have time, as we know. The Nushina teached a little different. So Al toima l'ksha'ef nash n'shem. Don't say, when I have time and I'm free and I'm relaxed and I'm serene and I'm open, then I'm going to learn. Shema loy sipona. Maybe your shlichus in life is not to learn when you're relaxed. Maybe your shlichus in life is to learn when you're stressed out. To go to the world of Torah when you do have burdens on your shoulders. So Reb Tzadik HaKoyin says, the Nachash introduced a thought into Adam. But it wasn't only a thought that he's a tzaddik. He's a tzaddik. That wasn't the thought. I mean, we all know with teenagers, it happens often in yeshiva, right? They read stories about Rabbi Akiva Eger, then they read stories about the Pnei Yeshua, then they read stories about the Chafetz Chaim, then they read stories about the Baal Shem Tov, and one day the 16-year-old decides, he's the Chafetz Chaim, he's the next Rabbi Akiva Eger, he's the next Baal Shem Tov, even better, he's the next Rabbi Akiva, or at least Rashi. And then 4 days later, and he starts steiging mamish because he's going to be the Gadol Hadar. Right? And then 4 days later, he's walking in the street, and suddenly he sees something and he realizes, as Nishkin Rabbi Akiva Eger, he's no Rashi, he's certainly no Rabbi Akiva, and he's not a Chafetz Chaim either. And often he goes down into the dumps. Why? Because the false delusional expectations of not understanding who you are and what God wants and needs from you. What do we say? They say, all people are born originals, but most of us die as copies. With Adam HaRishon, though, the thought is not just, I'm going to be a tzaddik, or I'm going to be a Chafetz Chaim, because Adam HaRishon lived a few years before the Chafetz Chaim. With him, the thought was much better. V'yisim ke'elokim. Actually, God. I'm God. And that's what the tzaddik is going to describe. Adam HaRishon shayim b'tachlis hashleimus. He was a perfected person, imagine. He is a man created directly by Hashem, right? Taka, somebody without a father and also without a mother. The only man who was created without a father and without a mother who did not tell him what to do. He didn't even have a shvigar. Which is why he lived till the age of 930 years. That was just a joke. Don't worry. V'adam arishin shahayah betachas hashleimus al derech ani amarti alekim atem. Adam, who was really tachlis hashleimus, it was no joke. This man was created directly by God. This is before the Eitz Hadas. The Nachash puts in an imagination as a shtick God. He is God. This is who he is. Says the Medrash Rabbah, Yachol Kamayni. You think you're going to be as holy as me? Talmud Loimar Ki Kadosh Ani K'dushasi L'mayla M'kdushascha. Vector Psadik HaKoyin, really? The Medrash has to tell us that God says, Yachol Kamoini, you can't be like me.
So he says, Kikshahu betachas amadrege mikdusha. Atshe yidma lemalachi asharis. Hu bekoyach abchirishaboy. Ein hayetzahore manichoy leoylam klal. Umesisoy shayuchel leeskadish kavayochel kamayam amash. A person reaches the zenith of holiness to the point that he's like an angel, but he's greater than an angel. You know why? Because by him it's with bchir, it's with choice. He's not a robot. He's not programmed like a computer. He became an angel through his koyach abchira. Now you think you have no yetzahara, says Reb Tzadik. And certainly this is well ingrained in the tradition of Kotsk. Don't think the yetzahara ever leaves you. He never leaves you. It's just a different type of yetzahara. The Kotsk Rebbe once said that the yetzahara comes to a person even as he's breathing his last breaths. What's the yetzahara then? A guy is a goyses, he's about to pass away. Classic Kotsk Rebbe's vort. He says the yetzahara comes to you and says, Rebbe Yisrael, don't just die. Right before you die, say Shema Yisrael with a lot of kavana. So for generations, everybody will talk about how you died. So that's the Yetzirah. The Baal Shem Tov, he passed away Shavuos Tavkuf Chaf, 1760. So one of the Talmudim describes that he bent over, the Baal Shem Tov was saying something, and he heard the Baal Shem Tov saying, Al tevoy eini regel gaiva. Moments before he left this world. The Baal Shem Tov, Al tevoy eini, don't bring me to the leg of arrogance. Says Reb Tzadik, the Yetzirah is there. What's the Yetzirah? What's the Yetzirah? He's a Malach. The Yetzirah says, look how holy you are. One step up. You could yachal kamayni. You could become the divine. You could become God. You could mamish become God. Umizeh, once this happens, yuchala apiloi me igri rama libira mikta chas v'shalom. Once this happens, he can lift this person from the highest heights. Igri rama libira mikta is an expression in Chagiga daf hei amid beis. From the highest mountain, libira mikta, to the deepest abyss, to the deepest pit. And then Reb Tzadik says these words. K'may shekare l'ha'ish u'l'shapsi tzvi shem rishayim yirka. This happened to two people. To the Ish, who's the Ish? The Ish is Oisei HaIsh, Yoshke, Yeshu, and Shapsi Tzvi of the 17th century, mentioned earlier. Al Yedei Ribui Prishusa. Don't think these were just immoral, lowly souls. No, Ribui Prishusa. They were so parush. They were so spiritually enlightened, segregated from materialism, sublimated, elevated. Govar koyach ha-dimyon shebehem lachshav sheyuchlu lidomis la'elyon. So what happened was their imagination, their power of imagination prevailed over them to think that they could become a mirror, a reflection, become just like the Elyon, Hashem. Of course, he's quoting the words of he's paraphrasing the words of Nebuchadnezzar, who says, Ele el bamose of Adama la'elyon, right? Nebuchadnezzar says, I will be Doime, I will be God. What happened was that as a result of their tremendous spiritual work, they truly considered themselves holy, and this took them to the next step, which is you're not just holy, but you are God Himself. And once you cross that boundary of humanness, once you don't see yourself as the mortal, frail human being, now you can end up in the abyss. This is what it means that the nachash instigated. Shemaschil b'muat. Starts off very slow. Ad chuli, until it ends up very low. U'tchilosei b'machshava v'dimyin. It starts off with thoughts. U'b'levush achitzayni shal machshava. And it starts off with a very external force. It's a garment. Elishenegei lechol madregis shemachshava k'di'is hasham v'chol zman shaloi nisken chet adam arishon legamri shehi ha'idei Mashiach ha'mekuvah b'mheira b'yameinu ein ha'machshava nekiya legamri adayin b'demyoynes kol echad k'fi madregasa. Till this mistake of Adam is not completely fixed, we still have to deal with this, that every person has delusions, expectations, and thoughts about themselves and other people that are completely inconsistent with reality, and this is a source of tremendous tension. He continues, even the holy person can have terrible machshavas, which ultimately could cause him tremendous desperation, And once there is desperation, there is sadness. And once there is sadness, there is despair. And once there is despair, the person gives up on themselves. As the Gemara says, Yiyush Shaloi Midas. And the Halakha Rishonim says, Yiyush is Shaloi Midas. Wherever there is Yiyush, there is the spirit Shaloi Midas. There's missing real das. It's das, but it's eitz das toivera. It's not the das that a person should have. Understanding that in every situation they're connected, and they have to know who they are, who they're supposed to be, and work with that. And from there, they become godlike as a human being. As a human being, they become Adam al-Elyon. The Shalah writes, Adam is Miloshin Adam al-Elyon, but as a human being, he's Adam al-Elyon. She's Adam al-Elyon. It perhaps is similar to what the Gemara says in Yumad Chav Beis. The Gemara says, why is it that Shaul, who was as pure as sugar, the Gemara says, like Tom Chet, he was a pure tzaddik, and yet he failed as a king. And David HaMelech, who makes mistakes, and some serious mistakes, he's forgiven, and he continues to be the king. And the Gemara basically says, Ein ma'midin tarnas al atzibur, elim kein kupur shal shrotzim tluyo loy ma'achayrav. You can't be a leader unless there's a kupur shal shrotzim, a box of dead rodents hanging down your back. Why? Because if you become arrogant, the people can tell you, just turn around and see what's hanging down your back. So Rashi explains that Shaul's problem was that he was too perfect. He was too good. Nobody could tell him, look at the Kupa Shal Shratzim. With David HaMelech, it was a machaya. If David HaMelech gave a shir, and he gave some musr, and you didn't like what he said, the guy in the back said, oh, tell me, who is this Baba? What's his yichis? Amoyov. Amoini v'loy mayavi. Ah, is he even a Jew? The Gemara in Yavam is the fire involved, the whole sugya. Doye Gadoimi said he's not even royal love of Bakal. David's family's not allowed to marry a Jew, right? The whole Maisa did. Dokar Nichnas l'beis hamedrish. V'amar kach mekublani mipishmol haramasi amoini v'loy amoinis mayavi v'loy mayavis. Call me Shainer Shemel Allahazu Yidaka Bekherev. Yisra Yisraeli. It was a big debate. Was Rus allowed to marry Boaz or not? Especially that Boaz died the next day. So with David it was no problem. He said something he didn't like. He's telling us how to live. Who's his wife, Bathsheba? Interesting. Who was the Shatchin? Moshe Rabbeinu gave a speech. He didn't like what Moshe Rabbeinu said. He's interesting. Which yeshiva did Moshe Rabbeinu learn in? Where was he? Slabotka, Ponovich, Chevron, Brisk, Slutsk, Kletsk, Lutzrin. Which yeshiva was Moshe Rabbeinu in? Where did he get his smicha? Ah, by Paroi. That's where he was ordained. That's it. Amachaya. Zagde Gemara, you know what Shaul's problem was? Nobody had a file on him. You know, today we have a file on everybody. You don't like a certain rabbi, you open a file and say, let me tell you what his Zayda did after the war. In the DP camps. You know, today, even before Google, we had our filing cabinets. Certainly after Google, you have on everybody a file. Oh, Hainti became the Tzadik Hador. I remember him as a teenager. Should I tell you what I once saw him do Friday night? With Nishreiden. I don't want to ruin it. I'm a Chaya. Shaul, nobody had any stories about him. He was a perfect guy. He was a Tzadik Yisoid Olam. The Gemara says that was the problem. That was the problem. There was no Kupur Shal Shratzim, and it doesn't. And when you don't have those proportions, when you don't have that humility as a leader, you fail. It's a fascinating idea. So this is how Reb Tzadik HaKoyen explains one of the components of the story of Shapsi Tzvi, and before him the story of another person who proclaimed himself as Mashiach, Oseh Ish Yashka. Now let's see a story with the Baal Shem Tov. This is recorded in the Sefer Shvachei HaBaal Shem Tov. Now, the stories of Shvachei HaBaal Shem Tov have been discussed over centuries. Are they all authentic? Are they not all authentic? Are there exaggerations? I think it was the Apterov who said, if you believe every story they say about the Baal Shem Tov, you're a fool. But if you believe that the stories couldn't happen, he says, you're an apikoris. But this is a story in Shvachei HaBaal Shem Tov. And it's quite a fascinating story. You have it in your sources. If you turn around to page 2, the second page, the second side, the second paragraph, Shvachei HaBaal Shem Tov. It's quite a fascinating, extraordinary story. Let's read. V'oit Sipeli Rav Yoyel, the Kehila Kadisha Nemirov.
The author says, I heard this maisa from Rabbi Yoel, pa machas, bo shapsi tzvi yemach shemoyle bal shemtev levakish mimeno shiyasakenois. Remember, Shapsi Tzvi died just a few years before the Baal Shem Tov was born. The Baal Shem Tov was born in 1698, Shnas Nachas, Hey Alofim Tof Nun Ches, and passed away, Tof Kuf Chaf. Shapsi Tzvi died a few years earlier. Shapsi Tzvi comes to the Baal Shem Tov, obviously, after his death, for a tikkun. He wants the Baal Shem Tov should fix him. But Amar Rabbi Yoel Hanal Bazalosh, Rabbi Yoel told me these words. Hatikun hu liskashe nefesh benefesh, ruach beruach, neshama benashama. This itself is fascinating. How are you misakin somebody? You can't just sit on the side and be misakin somebody. To be misakin somebody, you have to connect your nefesh to their nefesh, your ruach to their ruach, your neshama to their neshama. In other words, you have to not only find the kinship between you and the other person, you have to completely integrate your soul with their soul, your consciousness with their consciousness, your spirit with their spirit, and then you can really fix them. This tells us about the true therapeutic spiritual process of what tikkun is, to really, really, really fix somebody. If you don't completely identify and connect with that person's soul, you can't really correct, you can't correct them. You could give them mussar, you could scream at them, you get angry at them, you could pound the table, you could punish them, but that's not tikkun. You're not going to sublimate them. You won't transform them. So this is what the Baal Shem Tov has to do. That means when a neshama comes to a tzaddik and says, I want a tikkun, the tzaddik can't just say, okay, you know, go to Uman, you know, read the tikkun aklali, right? Give tzedakah, learn Torah every day, which may be excellent advice, but that's not enough. That's not enough. You got to go into the person. They say there was once the Rebbe Reb Shmuel, the Maharash, he was the Reb Shmuel of Lubavitch, the fourth Chabad Rebbe, had two sons. The older was Reb Zalman Aaron, and the middle one was Reb Shalom Ber, who later succeeded his father, is known as the Rebbe Rashab. So the younger brother once playing, you know, kids play house. So what do kids who grow up in a Rebbe's house? They also play house. Rebbe and Chassid, not Tati and Mami, Rebbe and Chassid. So the Rashab, Reb Shalom Ber, is a little boy, 4 years old, 5 years old. He comes into his older brother, Reb Zalman Aaron Razah, as a Chassid, and he says, I have two questions. One is a shayla, this is Chabad lexicon, one is a shayla in Haskola, and one is a shayla in Avoida. Meaning, one is a theological question, and one is a question about personal growth. So his brother says, what's your shayla in Haskola? He says, what's a Jew? What's his Ayid? He says, Ayid is fire. A Jew is fire. Passion. So he says, so why when I touch you, don't I get burnt? He says, Val du bist euch fire. Fire, you're also fire, fire touches fire, doesn't get burnt. What's your question in Avoida? Avoida is, the Baal HaTanya paskins in his Siddur, not in his Shulchan Aruch, in his Siddur, he paskins not to crack nuts on Shabbos. Why? Because too many problems. Between Boyer and Muktzah, there could be mamash chilul Shabbos if you crack it. Even though halachically you could crack a nut on Shabbos, it's not a problem. But since the shells stay around and it's mamash muktzah, plus there's often boirer because the nut remains with a little husk, and you remove the husk, it's mamash boirer min ha-toyra. You need a carbon chatos. So Baal Tanya says, all nuts that you want to eat, you should prepare from before Shabbos, which is the minig by Chassidic Chabad, according to the Psak in the Siddur. Although in Shulchan Aruch, he doesn't say it. So the Rashab says to his brother that I cracked open a nut on Shabbos. I ate a nut on Shabbos. So his brother says, he's 4 years old. So his brother says, he gives him a tikkun. What was the tikkun? I think the tikkun was that he has to, when he davens, he has to look in the Siddur a whole time and read every word from the Siddur. I'm not sure, but I think that was the tikkun. So the Rashab looks at him and he says, "Du bist nicht kein Rebbe. You're not a Rebbe." He says, "Why?" He says, "A Rebbe, fardem was a gita tikkun, gita frier a krechtsch." A Rebbe, before he gives a tikkun, first sighs. There was no sigh. You right away had a solution. You didn't sigh. This is what a four-year-old man, a kid said. In other words, if you're not empathizing with me, if you're not feeling my pain, stop giving me tikkunim. So Rabbi Yoel says here that the Baal Shem Tov has to connect nefesh b'nefesh, ruach b'nefesh, ruach b'ruach, nesham b'nesham. V'hischil iskasher imoy b'mason. I think what this means is the Baal Shem Tov starts connecting to him
slowly, deliberately. Because if I'm connecting to you, you're going to influence me too. It's not just a one way. It's a two-way street. And Baal Shem Tov was afraid. And therefore, he started to connect very slowly. And the Baal Shem Tov had a reason to be afraid. Pa machas yoshna Baal Shem Tov. One's the Baal Shem Tov, who's trying to correct Shapsi Tzvi, is sleeping. Uba Shapsi Tzvi upitu oisoy sheyishtamid chas v'shalom. Imagine. Shapsi Tzvi comes to the Baal Shem Tov and Kivayachal starts trying to persuade him to do what he did. What did Shapsi Tzvi do in 1666? The Sultan of Turkey called him in and said, Mr. Tzvi, you have a choice. Either you convert to Islam or you come out of this room with a head shorter. And Shapsi Tzvi did what many did. He converted to Islam. And Shapsi Tzvi Kivayachal took the Baal Shem Tov and threw him down very, very... No, I guess the Baal Shem Tov took... The Baal Shem Tov took Shapsi Tzvi and threw him down. Now, you came for a tikkun. What happens as a result, right? Right? You come to somebody because you're an addict and you say, come put me into rehabilitation. They're taking you to rehabilitation and you give them drugs. Right? So the Baal Shem Tov takes Shapsi Tzvi and throws him down all the way into the abyss. So Shapsi Tzvi was trying to come up. He was cast down by the Baal Shem Tov. The hitzitz of Baal Shem Tov makam chaniyasa. The Baal Shem Tov gazed, where does Shapsi Tzvi hang out? Remember, Shapsi Tzvi was coming up for a tikkun. The Baal Shem Tov cast him down back to his spiritual space. He wanted to see, where does he hang out? V'ra'a shehu im Yeshu al shulchan echad shekoyrim. How do you read this? Table. Tabil. He sees that he's sitting with Yeshu on one table. That's what he saw. So he realized that this wasn't just Shapsi Tzvi. This was also Yashka involved. Va'amar said the Baal Shem Tov. Said Reb Yoya. Sha'a Baal Shem Tov Amar. The Baal Shem Tov said the story and he said, Shahoya boy nitzutz Mashiach. He had a spark of Mashiach. Ela shetofsay asamachmem b'mitzudosay rachman alitzlan. A spark was there. In other words, what the Baal Shem Tov is saying is, don't think that something happens in history by mistake. For a person to have such a power to change the world, it's not coming from nowhere. There's a psanitzus, but the samachmen captured him in his net and therefore perverted and used the nitzutz in a negative, destructive way. Rabbi Yoel says, I heard the whole story of the Baal Shem Tov, who said, how did the Samachmem make him fall? Two things, godless, arrogance, and anger. V'ani misrash lichtoy. The Shvach Kabbalah says, what should I do? I'm too lazy to write. Maybe he meant more than lazy. But efshish echtoy, you know what? At second thought, maybe I should write it. Kedei sheyedu eich amuk hu agai v'veloy gavoya. So that people should understand how deep arrogance is. Not tall, but deep. So maybe I should write it. He never wrote it. But he did write that he should write what the Baal Shem Tov said. What is interesting here, that Reb Tzadik HaKoyen in Machshavas, Machshavas Charutz, echoes and mirrors a similar sentiment to what he quotes in the name of the Baal Shem Tov about Gadlus and Kas. Which now brings us to the next step. And the next step is a teaching from the Arizal in Pri Etz Chaim. Zok Tehelika Arizal in Pri Etz Chaim, and now of course we go to the era pre-Baal Shem Tov, and of course pre-Shapsi Tzvi, because the Arizal passes away in 1572, which is 100 years, which is more than 100 years before the Baal Shem Tov, in Tzvas. One of the works of the Arizal, transcribed by the Chaim Vital, is Pri Etz Chaim. Let me read it to you. Zok the Arizal in Pri Etz Chaim, Shaar Rosh Chodesh, Chanukah and Purim, Peir Gimel. Yeshu Hanoitzri was a reincarnation of the soul of a very famous person. Who? Esav. And Arizal says, you don't have to look far. How do you spell the name Esav? Ayin, Sin, Yud, Vav. Which is exactly the name Yeshua, which was his name. His name was Yeshua. He's called Yeshu. By Jews, he's often called Osiyahish, or in the English translation, Jesus. But the real name is Yeshua, which is Yud, Shin, Vav, Ayin, the letters of Esav. Because he was a Gilgal of Esav. Talmud, Rabbi Yeshua ben Prachin. And that's why the Gemara says in Kiddushin Daf Yud Ches Amud Aleph that Esav has the status of a Yisrael Mumar, a Jew who left, a Jew who's Mumar, who substituted his faith. Ask the Mefarshim, why is Esav a Yisrael Mumar, but Yishmael is not a Yisrael Mumar, as the Gemara says? Yishmael was a son of Avram, and the son of Hagar, who was Avram's Shifcha, who was married to Avram, Avram's concubine. Why is it? It's fine. Why is it that Yishmael is not a Jew? Esav is a Jew. So the Ramban in Parshas Emor asks the question, and the Ramban answers that the moment Avram Avinu went into the Bris, so then what happens? All of his descendants are called Yisrael, so therefore Yishmael is born before. Yishmael only had a bris at 13, but Esav is born, of course, after, so therefore Esav is a Jew. That's what the Ramban says. Kabbalistically, this is rooted in the words of the Arizal. Why? Esav hu Yisrael mumar k'may shahaya loyla nishmasay. Acharei shedachar Rabbi Yeshua ben Prachya b'shtei yadayim v'yotza min hadas. Basically, Esav represents the soul of Yeshu. After Rabbi Yeshua ben Prachya rejects him, he creates this new religion, as the Gemara says in Soita, or at least engages and entices people to Avodah Zarah. That's the status of Esav. He's a Jew, but he is a Yisrael Mumar. That's the story of his neshama. And that's why the Pasuk says Esav is Avi Edom, and Esav is associated with Edom, and everybody associates Edom with Rome and with Christianity, and it's very problematic historically, because what's the connection between Edom and Christianity and Rome? And it's Ad Hayom Hazeh, it's debated. Kabbalistically, Esav is Yeshu. Esav is Edom. Rome embraces Christianity in the year 325. Constantine imposes the Christian religion on the Roman Empire. And he says, that's why the prophecy of Avadia about Edom, which we read in Parshas Vayishlach, is really a prophecy on Christianity. When Avadia Hanavi, who's a ger, he's a ger from Edom, the Gemara says in Sanhedrin, Mineu vei ova l'shada beinarga, right? The handle of the axe, which you use to cut down the tree, is made from the tree. So Avadia, who comes from Edom, prophesies about Edom. One of the things Avadia says is, Mechamas achicha Yaakov techascha busha. From the robbery, the abuse that you caused to your brother Yaakov, shame should cover you. Al masheratfu es Yaakov b'chol hadoides, b'roiv hashmodois yimach shema. This is not just, what did Esav do to Yaakov? What did Esav do to Yaakov? We know what Yaakov did to Esav. Esav had thoughts. He wanted to kill his brother. Okay, I know a lot of people would like to kill their brothers. Huh? You? Don't do it. What did Esav do? He says, it's not Esav. It's the Hamas. It's hundreds and hundreds and thousands of years of pogroms, of inquisitions, of holocausts, of persecution, of murder, etc. And then the Mekobolim bring that this is also indicated in the Pesukim. And Parshas tells us, how does the Pasuk introduce Esav? By he Esav ish yoideya tzayit. By he Esav ish yoideya, the last letters are Yeshua. Vayihi is Yud, Esav is a Vav, Ish is Shin, Yodeya is an Ayin Yeshua. When the Pasuk says, Vahaya Yeresha Seir, he's going to inherit Seir, it's the Rosh HaTevis, Vav Yud Shin, Yeshua. When it says, Velo Yiyah Sarid Lebeis Esav, the Navi says there will not be a remnant to the house of Esav, Velo Yiyah Sarid is Vav Yud Shin, again, the acronym is Yeshu. when it says v'noikev shem Hashem mois yomos, somebody who curses the name of God, v'noikev is vav, shem is shin, Hashem yudke vavke is yud, vav shin yud, again you have the acronym of Yeshu. So this is all based on the teaching of the Arizal that we're dealing with the soul of Esav, the son of Yitzchak, who certainly had a very high soul to the point that Yitzchak wanted to bless him. Here, we can connect this to another fascinating teaching that I saw quoted in a letter by Rabbi Avraham Yitzchak HaKoyen Kuk, Zichrono Levracha, the first chief rabbi of Eretz Yisrael, who passed away in 1935, I believe, in the month of Elul. Right, 35? Tofer Tzadikei, right? Rav Kook, there's a sefer called Igrois. Igrois, HaRav Avram Yitzchak HaKayin, Igrois HaRiyah, HaRoya. The letters of Rav Kook. And there, somebody asks him about the relationship between Judaism and Christianity. So he quotes the famous Me'iri. There's a famous Me'iri in Masechta Avodah Zarah, Masechta Sanhedrin, which is a fundamental idea that all the Gemaras and all the Halachas about the relationship between Jews and Gentiles, including many difficult statements, refer to the ancient pagan idol worshippers who would slaughter their children to gods and whose immorality was despicable. However, when you talk about the Me'iri says, the Christian Gentiles, based on an ethic of morality and Sheva Mitzvahs B'nei Noyach, at least in principle, idealistically, this doesn't apply at all. To the contrary. And this is the Psak Halacha, similar to what the Ramah says, that a Goy is allowed to be a Christian, and it's not Avodah Zarah, meaning it fits in with the Sheva Mitzvahs B'nei Noyach. And the Be'er HaGoyle in Shulchan Aruch, the great grandfather of the Vilna Gaon, the Be'er HaGoyle, Reb Moshe writes, Lahalacha, that for these Gentiles you have to pray, you have to help out, you have to be respectful, you have to try to assist them in every possible way. It's the status, more or less, of a Ger Toshav. The Ger Toshav is the person upon whom the Torah says, V'chei imach. You're mechuyev to help him, to sustain him, to give him life, to give him charity, and to respect him in every possible way. And this is basically the shita of the Me'iri and many other poiskim lahalach. Says Rav Kook, our job in the world is not to denigrate, to mock, and to bring out the negativity, but rather to hope for the day when the authentic sparks of all other philosophies will be extricated from the shells and husks that eclipse the authenticity, and they will therefore be reunited with holiness. In other words, what he's saying is, when Mashiach comes, we speak about, we'll soon see the Rambam, we'll finish with the Rambam, how the world will be transformed, where everybody will worship one God. So what does it mean? It means that every Zen Buddhist is going to come to Shul. You want Zen Buddhists to start eating Yerushalmi Kugel Shabbos afternoon? You really want every Christian Gentile to start doing jalapeno herring after Musaf and listen to sermons of rabbis all over the world? I mean, from just that themselves, they can perish. That's Mashiach? This is really what we want to introduce to the world? The pshat is this. Almost every philosophy and religion in the world has sparks of authenticity, sparks of Torah. For example, in Christianity, there's so much based on Sheva Mitzvahs Bnei Noach and Amuna. However, those sparks are coupled with a lot of other things that are nonsense or rubbish or sometimes destructive. What happens in the world of Tikkun is the sparks of each religion and philosophy that are come from Torah, that come from truth, will be liberated from the husks, and therefore every religion will find their kinship with Judaism because they will realize those sparks of holiness that are part of them, that are really a reflection of Yiddishkeit and Torah, and therefore there will all automatically be a unified, holistic world worshiping one true God. And then the Vilna Gaon quotes a teaching from the Vilna Gaon, which is an absolutely incredible teaching. The Vilna Gaon quotes the pasuk that we read in the Haftarah of Ayetzer. Says the Navi Malachi, Va'oyev Haloyoch Esav LeYaakov. Esav is a brother to Yaakov. They're brothers. Va'oyev Es Yaakov. What are the next words? Ve'es Esav Sanesi. I loved Yaakov, and Esav I despised, I loathed, I hated. What does this mean? There's Esav Sanesi. Yitzchak loved Esav. Yitzchak wanted to bless him over Yaakov. Rivka changed the plan. What does it mean, there's Esav Sanesi? So some like to say what the Radak says. The Radak says, Vayar Hashem kisnua Leah. Yaakov hated Leah. Hated Leah. He hated his wife. So what does the Radak say? Doesn't mean he hated Leah. It means whenever you love two people, but one person you love more than the other, the second person perceives themselves as hated. If you have two children, you love them both, but one of the children you love more than another child, remember that that child is not going to see themselves as loved. They're going to see themselves as hated. So snua means relative to the intense love of the first one. Comes the Vilna Gaon and says, I don't understand. Why does it say S? V'oyev es Yaakov. V'es es of Sonesi. V'es the ace of Sanesi. Zak de Vilna Gaon. What does the word S mean? What does the Gemara say? What does S mean? S means S psaray. Verachatz S psaray. What does the Gemara say? S hatofel psaray. Doesn't say verachatz psaray by mine. Wash your flesh in water. Wash S. What's S? That which is tofel psaray. You're here. Your nails, that which is subservient to your body, which is secondary to your body, which can be removed from your body. That's what has to go to the mikveh. And that's S. Bereshis S HaShemayim V'es HaRetz. What does Chazal say? What's S? S HaShemayim L'Rabbi Sva'ayim. S HaRetz L'Rabbi Sva'ayim. All the legions of heaven and earth. Kabbal S HaVichel L'Rabbi Sva'ayim. The Gemara says, the famous Gemara, right in Pesachim. Shimon Am Suni HaYadoyrish. Call Essen Shabbatoira till he came to Es Hashem Alekechatira Piresh, who you're supposed to fear together with God. Achabar Rabbi Akiva, Akiva says, Es Hashem Alekechatira L'Rabbis Talmidei Chacham. So you know what the Kotzker says. Rabbi Akiva said, L'Rabbis Talmidei Chacham, even Talmidei Chacham have to fear God. What was the problem of Shimon HaMsoini? Who are you supposed to fear together with Hashem? Achabar Rabbi Akiva. Says the Vilna Gaon, the S Ace of Sanesi. You know which part of Esav I hate? The S of Esav. I despise the things Vasabin Zichzuge klept. All those components that attach themselves to Esav, but they don't constitute the core, the essence, the root of Esav. And that's why we know in the Gemara in Saita what happened by Yaakov's funeral. Esav was killed by Chushim, right? And what happened to Esav's head? It rolled into whose grave? Yitzchak's grave. It says in Targum Yonason, they should the Esav be it for the Yitzchak. The head of Esav is buried in the bosom of Yitzchak. Ask the Chachmei Achsidus. The halacha is you don't bury a tzaddik near a rasha. How can Yitzchak ad hayom hazeh be buried near Esav? Pshat is reisha de Esav. There's the head of Esav, there's the body of Esav. The head of Esav represents who Esav is in his source, in his potential, in his calling, in his neshama. The tragedy of Esav is that there was a disconnect, a dissonance between the head of Esav and the manifestation of Esav. What Yitzchak saw in Esav was a tremendous soul, even greater than Yaakov. The Baal HaTanya writes in Torah Ohr that Esav comes from Toyu and Yaakov comes from Tikkun, and Toyu is higher than Tikkun. The problem of Toyu is that it went through a breaking of the vessel, Shviras HaKelim, and therefore Esav fell down very low. Nobody understood Esav because Esav in his manifestation in this world was aggressive, was immoral, was dysfunctional, was destructive, but Esav in his core was really fragile, sensitive, powerful, intense, holy, sacred. That's the tragedy of Esav. There was a disconnect. The spark fell down. The S Esav Sanesi, the sin is to the S of Esav. But when you go back to the core, to the nitzutz, to the source, says the Vilna Gaon, there Esav is together with Yitzchak. He's one with Yitzchak. And that's essentially the nitzutz of Esav, which according to the Arizal, Rav Kook doesn't mention this, I don't know if he saw that Chassidic Chaim,
But according to the Arizal, Esav, this is Yeshua. And the Baal Shem Tov says there was a tremendous spark. And Tzaddik says there was a tremendous spark. But it went through a tremendous nefila, which is similar to the nefila of Esav, who becomes Esav Harasha, even though Yaakov, Yitzchak wanted to sublimate. You probably know the vort of the Chiddush Yerim. You know the Chiddush Yerim? Moiridik. The Chiddush Yerim writes in Parshas told us, this itself is a shir. Why did Rivka have to fool her husband? Why couldn't Rivka go into Yitzchak and say to Yitzchak, you mean well, but Esav doesn't deserve the blessings. Give them to Yaakov. Why do you have to deceive your husband? Says the Chiddush Yerim, if Rivka would have done that, you know what would have happened? Yitzchak would say, Rivka, you're right. Bring Yaakov in. So what would Yaakov do? I'm going to use my own words. Yaakov would go to the mikveh. He would daven. He would learn. He would put on his kapota, his bekesha, his shrimal, his gartel. He would say l'shem yichud. He would do his boidudus. And then he would go into Yitzchak for the bracha. He would come in, ahele kiyid, and he would get the brachas. But Rivka was a Yiddish mama. And Rivka had to decide one thing at that moment. Who is going to get the brachas of Yitzchak? Is it only going to be the Jew who looks like the Jew? Or is it also going to include the Jew who doesn't look like the Jew? By having Yaakov dress up like Esav and get the brachas, Rivka guaranteed that for the next few thousand years, even those Jews who dress like Esav, look like Esav, speak like Esav, project themselves like Esav, disguise themselves as Esav, want to be like Esav, because they feel that is how they will be accepted in the world. Even those Jews are included in the eternal covenant of Yitin Lecha Elikim Mital Hashamayim Mishmanei Aretz, as the Medrash says, Mital Hashamayim Zumikra Mishmanei Aretz Zumikna Mishna Dagon Dagon Zubraisa Tider Zugemara. The whole body of Mital Hashamayim Mishmanei Aretz, heaven and earth, was given even to the Jew who looks like Esav, but internally he or she is really Yaakov. Chiddush Yerim Parshas told us. Because even Esav himself on a deeper level has this dissonance, has this tragedy. Ve'es Esav Sanesi. What I despise about Esav is the tuffel. And it's true in every person. In every person we have elements of Esav. But you have to be able to distinguish between the S and between the essence. You can't confuse the S and the essence. You can't look in the mirror and see Esav and say, that's it. I'm Esav, I'm done, I'm the worst of the worst. You gotta hate your S, but don't confuse your S with your core, with your essence. Finally, we'll conclude with the Rambam. The Rambam, I think it's extremely appropriate to conclude such a class with the words of the Rambam. Actually, the second to the last chapter of the whole Sefer Mishneh Torah Yad HaChazaka LaRambam, the last halacha of Rambam is Hilchis Melachim UMelchamoseyem, and in their versions of Yemen, it's called Hilchis Melech HaMashiach. The Rambam dedicates the last two chapters of the Yad to Mashiach, to the Geula, Perik Yud Aleph and Perik Yud Beis. The end of Perik Yud Aleph is absolutely fascinating, and in most editions of the Rambam, again, it was deleted. You'll see why. However, the Rambams that were published under Muslim ruler, under Muslim in Muslim countries, like the Yemen Rambam, the Rambam Ksavya Teiman kept it, and that's why we still have this text of the Rambam's Mishneh Torah, even though most of the other Rambams never had it for many centuries. So let's take a look at Rambam. Rambam Hilchus Malachim, Perek Yud Aleph. You see, it's the last source. 1, 2, 3, 4 paragraphs from the bottom. Zok the Hilik Rambam. Ve'im yamoid melech mebeis David hoyge betoyle ve'isig mitzvus kedavid aviv kvi toyre shebeksav shebal pe. Ve'yakov kol Yisrael leilech bol chazik bitka ve'yilchem lchemes Hashem areze becheskes shu Mashiach. The Rambam gives us the criteria. How can you look at a person and say we can assume he has a chazaka of being Mashiach? What's the criteria? Melech from the house of David, involved in Torah and mitzvahs, Torah Shabbat and Malpeh, and influences V'yakov. He compels all the Jewish people to go in its ways and strengthen its broken parts, fights the wars of Hashem. We assume he's Mashiach. Im asa v'yitzliach, v'nitzach kalom l'shesviva, v'bana b'ktash v'mkein v'yikibitz nitchi yisal a'ez ha'Mashiach b'vada. If he goes on and he's successful, meaning He's victorious on all the nations. He builds the Beis HaMikdash. He gathers all the Jews back to Israel. Now it's not Cheskes Mashiach. Now it's Mashiach Bevada. In other words, it's not only we assume he is Mashiach, or he has the criteria of Mashiach, or maybe he has the potential to be Mashiach, but rather we say he is Mashiach. Hashem made him Mashiach, and he started the Lagula. He built the Beis HaMikdash. Obviously, he's Mashiach. What happens? Ve'im lo hitzliach at koyei nerak. What happens if he's not successful? Or he's killed. It's not the Mashiach that Torah promises. This doesn't mean anything wrong. He's like all the great kings of Beis David who were kosher, Erlich, Yidden, great Jews who passed away. He was so successful to a certain point. It's a test, and he brings the Pasuk in Daniel, but it's not Mashiach. Now come two parts of Rambam that were deleted. Look at the Rambam. Af Yeshua Hanoitzri. Shedima Sheyeh Mashiach V'Nerek Bebezdin. Here you see Shittas HaRambam. Yeshua Hanoitzri, who thought, who said he was Mashiach, and he was killed in Bezdin. Apparently, he's going with the Gemara in Sanhedrin Daf Mem Gimel, right? That he Talu B'Erev Pesach. Kvar nisnabe boy Daniel. Daniel has a nevua. Shenemar ubnei pritzei amecha yinosu lahamid chazoyin v'nichshol. V'chiyesh michshol gadol miza. Is there a greater michshol? A greater obstacle? Shekol ha-neviyim dibru sha-mashiach goyol yisrol u-mashiyim u-mekabit nitcheyim u-mechazak mitzvosam. V'zeh goram la-abed yisrol v'cherev l-fazir sh'enisim u-la-shpilim l-hachlif ha-teira u-la-hatis rei v'oilam la-avil l-kam b'ladei Hashem. Is this not a false Mashiach? All the prophets say, what is Mashiach going to do? He's going to redeem the Jewish people. He's going to help the Jewish people. He's going to gather the Jewish people to the Holy Land. He's going to strengthen their religion, their mitzvahs. This person, what did he cause as a result? Jews were hunted down by the sword. They were scattered. They were denigrated. The Torah was exchanged because Christianity nullifies most of the 613 mitzvahs. And most of the world is now serving a new God in addition to God, to the God of Avraham, Yitzchak, and Yaakov, monotheism. Meaning the idea of the Trinity. But the Rambam doesn't end here. Now says Rabbeinu Moshe ben Maimon. And Rabbeinu Moshe ben Maimon is writing when? The Rambam lives in the 12th century. Right? The Rambam was born in approximately 1135, Erev Pesach. Passed away at the age of 69 and a few days is his yahrzeit, Chav Teves, at the age of 69. In the year 1205, he lived under Muslim countries. Meaning the Rambam was born in Cordova in Spain. But the Almohads took over. The Almohads were like ISIS today. Mamash, the same thing. They weren't tolerant, liberal Muslims. And the Rambam had to run away, ran away to Morocco, went to Fez, went to Israel, went to Egypt, and ultimately settled in Egypt where he passed away and was the physician of Saladin, the great Sultan. Arafat used to compare himself to Saladin. And the Rambam lived under Muslim countries and wrote a lot about Islam and about Christianity. Zok the Rambam, Avo machshavas boirei oylam ein koyach ba'odam lahasigam. Don't think this is a random event. The creator of the world allowed this to happen, and his plans we don't understand, because a person can't understand God's mind or God's ways. All the events of Yeshu and of the Yishmaeli, meaning Muhammad, who rose up after Yeshu in the 7th century, creating the religion of Islam, you should know that it was all to pave a path for Melech HaMashiach to fix the world, to serve together one God, as the Pasuk says in Tzvanya, that one day all the nations will serve Hashem. Ketzah, how? You just told me that he was a false Mashiach because he created disaster, havoc, chaos, misery, suffering, agony. And we all know the Rambam couldn't write about this. Wasn't the Holocaust in Germany a direct result of 2,000 years of indoctrination that Jews are the epitome of the devil? Could the Holocaust take root among the Germans and so many Christians and others, if not for what Christianity did to the Jewish people over two millennia? So what is the Rambam now suddenly saying? We don't understand God's ways, but I want to tell you that it paved the path for Mashiach, for the real Mashiach. Ketzad, how? So the Rambam says, Kvar nismalei ha'olam kulei midivrei ha'mashiach. As a result of Yeshua HaNoitzri, the world speaks about Mashiach. The world is filled with the concept of Mashiach. Umidivrei ha'toyin umidivrei ha'mitzvahs. The concept of Torah, the concept of mitzvahs, came to the world. Upashtu dvarim elu be'im rechoikim u'ba'amim rabim orlei leiv ve'im noisim ve'noisim dvarim elu be'mitzvahs ha'toyin. And the idea spread to the furthest islands and among many nations who had stuffed, plugged hearts, meaning they were complete pagans, living in a very primitive and unethical lifestyle. And they're all debating and discussing these things and the mitzvahs. He now goes to all the different trends of Christianity. Some say that these mitzvahs used to be true. God once gave these mitzvahs to the chosen people, but now they're irrelevant. God changed the covenant. They're not timely anymore. They're not eternal. The mitzvahs are absolved. Other Christians say, no, the mitzvahs have mystical meanings. They're metaphors, they're allegories, they don't mean literal. And their Messiah came and he revealed what are the secrets of the mitzvahs. It doesn't mean literally tefillin, Shabbos, bris milah, lulav. It means ideas, ethical ideas. So there's a debate. Do the mitzvahs mean literal, but they're absolved now? Are the mitzvahs mysterious and allegorical and metaphoric? But the Rambam says, abasekachzich. In the world, there's a God, there's a Moshe Rabbeinu, there's Torah, there's mitzvahs, there's Mashiach. U'kesheyamid ha-melech ha-mashiach be'emes, v'yatzliach v'yarem v'yinase. And when Mashiach stands up, who's Mashiach? Melech ha-mashiach be'emes. In other words, the real Melech ha-mashiach and the real Geula happens, and he'll be successful. Miyat, right away. Miyat. Heim kulam choizrin. They all return. V'yoydim, and they know, she'sheker nachalu avoseyam. That their forefathers bequeathed them falsehood, and that their prophets and fathers made them error. So as a result of the monotheistic religions, meaning Christianity and Islam, which are both daughters of Judaism, although the distortions, the Rambam says, and the lies are well known, although the tragedy and the suffering was horrendous and is horrendous, now we're dealing with Yishmael. Esav has matured. Yishmael takes a little more time to mature. But this is his bar mitzvah year, 1300 years since Muhammad. So let's hope they have a bar mitzvah and they grow up a little bit. But the idea is that the monotheistic religions, despite the pain, Rambam says, we don't understand how Hashem runs the world and why he runs the world. But even these movements, ultimately, are part of the plan of the director of the play of history to pave the world towards a singular, holistic consciousness of goodness, of godliness, of holiness, and therefore when Mashiach actually comes, there will not be a need for years of transformation and education and metamorphosis. But immediately, they'll be able to identify the sheker from the emes, because the emes is really in them. It's part of them. As we explained before, the words of the Gaon and the Baal Shem Tov, etc., about the sparks, which I think gives more understanding to the words of the Rambam. And therefore, the words of the Navi, as epech al amim safa brura likre kulam b'shem Hashem la'avdo yishchem echot, will be fulfilled. And may this be b'mheira b'yameinu mamish. Amen. Thank you very much.